Gentlemen, can I welcome members of the press and public to the 19th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2015. Can I first of all ask all those present to ensure that electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they do not affect the work of the committee. Colleagues, can I move to agenda item number one, which is a decision in taking business in private. The question is that we take agenda items number 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Colleagues, can I move to agenda item number 2, which is oral evidence on the AGS report entitled the 2013-14 Audit of Coatbridge College Governance of Severance Arrangements. Can I say just before we begin our evidence today, I want to say a few words on record about the email that we received late last week from the Scottish Funding Council, forwarding a copy of the Linkston report. I know that colleagues share my frustration that this report has now only been shared with us by the Funding Council, particularly as it was in discussion with the Cabinet Secretary in July of this year about its relevance to the governance issues at the college. Now, I appreciate there may have been some sensitive issues around the report, but nevertheless, it is my view and the committee's view that would have been of assistance to the committee for this report and provided it as much earlier for our work. Also, the Funding Council also wrote separately last week with information relating to principal severance arrangements. They've undertaken to get the missing information to the committee by the 7th of December. They have advised that they did not see the business cases because they rely on the audit process. I think the committee would agree with me that it's imperative that we receive all of the information that's been requested and the relevant documents before we can move on with the deliberations on our draft report. Hopefully colleagues will agree with the statement. Okay, good morning again, and can I welcome our first panel of witnesses. I welcome John Doyle, the former Principal and Chief Executive of Coatbridge College, and John Gray, the former Board Chair of Coatbridge College. I understand that Mr Gray would like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The last time I was here, I talked about setting this inquiry in the context of the college merger process. The merger policy was instigated by the Scottish Government, and once groupings of colleges to be merged was finalised, very little direction was given as to the way this should be managed. College groupings were left to get on with the process the best way they could. In Lanarkshire, the proposal started out as a federation structure. It then moved to a merger proposal, and in the middle of this, Cumbernauld and Motherwell agreed a merger without involving Coatbridge or South Lanarkshire College. Coatbridge eventually capitulated and was effectively taken over. South Lanarkshire, as I understand it, is still not an integrated part of New College Lanarkshire. As this process was evolving, many discussions took place regarding process and rule setting, particularly regarding to severance payment arrangements for the many staff who were clearly going to lose their jobs through no fault of their own. The board policy from the start was to try to make sure Coatbridge staff were fairly treated and given proper job opportunities in the new structure, and for those forced to leave, a realistic severance scheme. As far as I'm concerned, the severance arrangements, when I left, are clearly described in the Remuneration Committee and Board minutes of the 23rd of October 2013. At no time was any suggestion put forward by anybody that the payment to John Doyle in particular was excessive or should be stopped or reconsidered. In short, the important points for me are that at the end of the day, all staff in Lanarkshire colleges who lost their jobs were to receive the same compensation. There was no proposal for any enhanced payment to senior managers. There was only one scheme. For the principal, the contractual entitlement to 6 months' pay in lieu of notice is a contractual matter and totally separate from any severance pay agreement. There was no payment made regarding his pension. The Scottish Funding Council made it clear that it would only fund up to the guideline amount, but if the board wanted to exceed this amount, this was its responsibility and the college would have to fund any balance required. This was understood by the whole board and was agreed without question at the meeting. I'd also like to clarify one or two other wee points. John Doyle never asked me for a severance package, either verbally or in writing. I served as chairman of the board for almost 12 years without remuneration. I was not entitled to any severance payment, nor did I receive any, contrary to some reports. The Funding Council confirmed that other colleges had made severance payments in excess of the guideline. Did their auditors comment on this, and will those colleges be subject to the same audit process that we have been? I'll leave that question with you. In conclusion, I believe there was no failure of governance on my part at Coatbridge. The auditor clearly did not examine the situation in sufficient detail before commenting in her report. She clearly did not see all of the relevant documents. And in particular, she made no approach to either John Doyle or myself for explanation or clarification. The Auditor General's comments had no foundation in fact. Her conclusions were entirely her own, were insulting and damaging, and should now be retracted. And if not, I would like to know the reason why not. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Gray. And Mr. Doyle, can I open questions by firstly clarifying for the record that you were the accountable officer for the Coatbridge College?
That's correct.
And for how long would you have been the accountable officer?
For the period I was in the post from November 2004 until I left on the 31st of October 2013.
So in terms of responsibilities of the accountable officer, those would be set out in the Scottish Funding Council's guidance of 2000, is that correct?
I understand so.
Yeah, and I take it that that's a document that as you have been an accountable officer, you'd have been familiar with, is that correct?
I made myself aware of it at the time through the clerk to the board to get, sent me a copy, as she was sending a copy to everyone else in the Remuneration Committee, and it was going on the board's intranet, and I read it at that point.
So you made yourself aware of it. So can I refer you to paragraph 18 of the document? And it says here, and if I can paraphrase part of it, it says the college's accounting officer has personal responsibility to notify the council's chief executive if they consider that the college or the board management plan of course of action that is in conflict with or infringes guidance or instruction that has been issued to the college or appropriate best practice. This is particularly important if it is a controversial or novel action that has been contemplated in any severance package. No. So I take it from this paragraph that it makes it clear that given that you that the college was proposing to go beyond the principles of the 13-month severance package, you had a personal responsibility as the accountable officer to provide that information to the Scottish Funding Council. Is that not correct?
Can I just confirm that everyone here has a copy of the submission that I sent in? I'm just going to address it because I hope in part in my submission on Monday I covered part of that, and I'll expand on that if I may, convener. When Mr. Gray, after the Remuneration Committee on the 28th, if memory serves me right, of January 2013, Mr. Gray came into the college the next morning and had a meeting with me with regards to the Remuneration Committee and in particular the conversation on my proposed severance agreement. I had read the documentation and we had a long conversation about the decision-making process by the Remuneration Committee and the rationale behind the decision that they'd made. I went over, as I've said in my statement, every aspect of it in terms of suitability, affordability, the rationale, and I thought I made that very clear in my submission. However, I'm very happy to expand on it. I was very aware of the guidance. I wanted to make sure I was engaged with the Remuneration Committee in the context that the guidance said that if there was something different, the explanation I got from the chair of the board who had met with the Remuneration Committee was...
But Mr. Doyle, can I just clarify the question I asked you, though? Within this paragraph, it makes it clear that given that you're going beyond the terms of the 13 months, let's I'll allow you to come back to your statement later in terms of the information provided, but please answer the question I put to you. It's very clear that you were going, it was proposed that it would go beyond the 13-month period that has been recommended by the Scottish Funding Council. So you had a personal responsibility. I can't find any legislation that says that you can decide at any point during this process that you're no longer the accountable officer. It's very clear that you have a legal responsibility as the accountable officer for that organisation to advise the Scottish Funding Council that the board are proposing to go beyond the terms that's been recommended by the Scottish Funding Council. Why didn't you advise them of that?
On the basis
you're not been straight with us here, Mr. Doyle, and this is one of the reasons why you're back before the committee. You're creating this smoke screen and sending us down all sorts of different pathways. It's a very clear question. Why didn't you, as the accountable officer, not provide that information to the Scottish Funding Council?
Well,
and also to both the external and the internal auditors. It makes it very clear in this document, which I expected you not to be just aware of, but to know in detail, that that's your responsibility as an accountable officer.
Well, I do, convener, take exception that I have in some way laid a smokescreen. Let me answer the question.
Have, yep.
Let me answer the question, if I may, please, yep. Directly. I was advised by the chair of the board, the chair of the remuneration committee, the next day that he had, in accordance with the guidance, spoken to Mark Battle, the then chief executive of the Funding Council, and advised them that it was the remunerations committee. Now, it was quite clear to Mark Battle that the remuneration committee of the board were going down a path that was in excess of the 13-month guidelines. Now, I was made aware of that the very next morning. I had a long conversation with the chair of the board on those aspects, and I was satisfied that the Funding Council, at chief exec level, were well aware of the detail, because the chair, as per the guidelines, had spoken to him about it.
But can I also refer to paragraph 19 of the Scottish Funding Council's guidance, which it says... It's paraphrased part of that paragraph. It says, it is not acceptable for the accounting officer, which is you, to abstain from their personal responsibilities by contending that they're not part of the remuneration committee or form any part of the process. As the intended best beneficiary of the severance package, the accounting officer will at some stage be made aware of the settlement, and he or these should then advise the committee on the appropriateness of the action. So I'm looking at this, and it makes it very clear that after the decision taken by the Remuneration Committee, you should give advice to the committee of the appropriateness of the action that they've taken. Now, should you not have advised the committee then that they're going beyond the terms of the Scottish Funding Council, and advise them then that you would then have to report that to the Scottish Funding Council? Not the responsibility of the board chair to do that. It was your personal responsibility. You were paid £116,000 per annum, a significant responsibility to be the accountable officer for the college. So why not take that seriously?
I'm very much took it seriously. That's why we, and in my written submission, but let me explain again that I had a long conversation with the chair of the board before I signed any agreement, where we went over all of the aspects appertaining to the decision-making process, and in particular the rationale, affordability, etc., of a severance package in excess of the guidelines. Now, it was only when I was satisfied, and I've written to that effect, it was only when I was satisfied that the Remuneration Committee had covered all of the facts, had a business rationale for the decision-making, it was affordable, they had looked at the costs, they had looked at reserves, the Chair of the Finance Committee was in attendance, that I was satisfied that I had met all the requirements at that stage of the guidance. There was no way a situation where I was trying to hide anything. I had a long conversation, John Gray and I, and it was only after I was satisfied that everything had been discussed, everything had been realised by the Remuneration Committee members, and they had a unanimous decision that I then said, well, that's fine, I'm now satisfied.
So what's very clear from this is that you had a personal responsibility. You are the accountable officer, not committee, not board, not federation. You, as the accountable officer, you have a personal responsibility. That's what you're paid for, and you didn't carry that through by ensuring that the Scottish Funding Council were aware that your board, whom you're the accountable officer for, were not made aware. You didn't make the Scottish Funding Council aware.
I'm sorry, convener. I have been just been briefed by the chair of the board that he had a long conversation with the chief exec. I was satisfied that the funding council were aware at highest level.
Convenient though, was it not?
I wouldn't say it was convenient.
It's pretty convenient for you not to have to be in the position where you had to advise the Scottish Funding Council that your board were going beyond the terms of the 13 months. It was very convenient personally for you, is it not?
I'm sorry. The guidance is quite clear.
It is clear, yeah.
The guidance is quite clear.
Absolutely.
The chair of the board had followed the guidance in contacting Mark Batho, the chief exec.
No, I'm not referring to the guidance. I'm referring to the guidance that's in the SFC that refers to you as the accountable officer. I'll speak to Mr. Gray later.
That's fine.
It's the accountable officer's role that you had a personal responsibility for that I'm referring to, not Mr. Gray.
And I considered that responsibility to be met when I was briefed by the chair of the board that they had that conversation and that the funding council was well aware of what they proposed to do.
So can I just finally move you to your evidence on the 28th of October, where you referred to the Federation Action Plan?
Yes.
Yeah, and you advise us that was the terms by which your severance package was agreed, is that not correct?
I'm not sure what you mean.
Well, in terms of the minute, you referred to your terms were set out in the Federation Action Plan, is that correct?
My terms, sorry, convener, I'm not being obtuse, but my terms of what?
Well, the action plan for Lanarkshire. So you advised that in column 41 and again in columns 44, you make reference to the Federation Action Plan for Lanarkshire.
In the context of severance packages for the Federation?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's a document that's been agreed by all of the federations? Is that something that's been agreed
from,
by all
from, my, from memory, from a couple of weeks ago, I'm sure I advised you that in November 2012, South Lanarkshire College had proposed a VS scheme, which was based around the Edinburgh model.
So clarify, proposed.
Absolutely.
So can I just refresh your memory? It says here, a scheme for, so on a federation action plan, a scheme for all staff in all of the four Lanarkshire colleges. And it was the intention of my board that plan would be made available to all staff.
Yes.
So that's the scheme which you enjoyed. Is that scheme that eventually you took advantage of, is that correct?
Just to finish answering your question, once South Lanarkshire College had presented a proposal to the Principals Forum of the Federation, it then went, you're quite correct, to the Federation Board, which consisted of the chairs and principals of the four colleges. The board hadn't had an action plan, and we were quite rightly getting asked to progress the federation along a more productive lines by the funding council. Within that action plan that was tabled to the federation included many things, including the severance package that South Lanarkshire College proposed. It was our intention in Coatbridge to embrace that package for all of the staff in Coatbridge.
Okay, and were you the person who proposed this particular action plan?
No, I didn't propose any action plan.
I understand it says here, no such plan exists. This is what we were advised by New College Lanarkshire. The advice is that the document was prepared by Mr. Doyle in 2012. So this action plan was prepared by you. That's what the advisers.
Right.
And it was circulated. I understand that they'll follow on with the information, but I understand that that you circulated this action plan. You were the author of it, and it was circulated to other Lanarkshire principals.
No,
that's
not technically accurate.
No,
and I'm very happy to do so, convener. What actually happened was we were at a meeting with the funding council, the Scottish Government rep, all the chairs, all the principals. John Kemp of the Funding Council and Linda McTavish, John Kemp of the Funding Council advised and cautioned the Federation board that there was not enough satisfactory progress on achievements by the Federation. It was suggested that required some sort of action plan. Coatbridge College agreed to produce a draft of that action plan containing all of the various actions from all of the four colleges and from the funding council if it was appropriate, and Coatbridge produced a draft. John Gray, myself, the executive team.
But it says here specifically you were the author of your a report.
Well, that I was not.
So is it John Gray now?
Who prepared
the document?
Myself and the management team in the college.
Right, so it's the management team.
Well, when you're producing something for other colleges...
So that document referred to severance arrangements?
It would have included a number of things, including severance arrangements
so
that were proposed.
How helpful do you think that was, that you were the author of your own severance arrangements? I mean, is that appropriate? You advised us some weeks ago...
Well, I'm sorry, I wasn't the author of my own severance arrangements.
Well, that's what you said the action plan refers to.
The action plan contains many things, convener.
Yeah, but it also contains severance arrangements.
Which was proposed by South Lanarkshire College.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying here. You're the author of a report.
No, that's not true.
That's what the college said. Lying then.
I didn't suggest that for a moment. Let me clarify quite clearly. We were in a situation with four colleges and a federation. The funding council had advised that we were not making satisfactory progress. They were looking for a smart action plan that took the federation as four individual colleges together to see some collective benefit. There hadn't been satisfactory progress, according to the funding council. It was agreed that we required an action plan. Coatbridge, I, with John Gray, said, we'll produce a draft. Any of the other colleges could have produced a draft. There were many things in that action plan. One of them was a severance agreement raised by South Lanarkshire College. I did not raise it. I did not recommend it to the Federation. We simply included it within the action plan. The action plan then went back as a plan sometime in December, January.
It was never agreed. Yes or no?
I can't remember, to be honest. Well, it was presented.
You presented it to us. Before I move on to Mary Scanlon, you presented it to us as if this is a deal that I've agreed because this is the Federation model, which my severance arrangements were based on. It was never formally agreed.
Sorry, convener, you're talking to the wrong person. I didn't produce the severance package for myself at all.
Yeah,
I had no insight into what was being discussed.
But you said you took advantage of that particular... In your evidence to us...
I did not say I took advantage.
You said that was the basis by which you agreed your severance package. The representations that were made on your behalf, that was the agreement, was you would take it. There was two severance packages. That was one of them, and you took advantage of that.
What was the other one?
The other one was... Well, you said there was two severance packages.
No, I didn't.
Proposed. Well, I think we've seen that in the official report.
I'm sorry, I didn't say there was two severance packages.
You did. You said there was two severance packages on the go. And that's why you had to...
No, I'm sorry. I did not say there were two severance packages on the go.
So what
is the other severance package that was on the go, as you say?
In the official report.
I have no recollection of another severance package
you said
apart
that you
from the Edinburgh
Bailey
model.
Had to be brought in because there was two packages, there was two proposals on the table at the time, and that's why Biggert Bailey had to be brought in to advise the board.
Talking 8 months, 9 months later.
Yes.
9 months later in September, New College Lanarkshire, which were perfectly entitled to do so, decided to go down another route.
Yeah.
And I wasn't aware they were going down another route until it was published. I thought I made that very clear. And 28th of January, 8 months before that, there was only one package that was being discussed by the four principals, and that was the package proposed by South Lanarkshire College. I had no input into its design, development, or indeed proposal. If you are referring to the two packages, it was only in September when there were two packages then. One was the Federation, which was lying there, yeah. South Lanarkshire.
That's the one you took advantage of.
I didn't take advantage of anything. I didn't propose my severance. I didn't propose any aspect of my severance
package.
That was
the one that you benefited from in the end.
I would have benefited from it, but I didn't propose it.
I appreciate that, but at the very end, the decision was to agree to that package. Is that correct? Based on that model.
It would have been based, yeah. I presume, based on that model. That's what the Chair has said.
Yeah. Mary Scanlon?
Mr. Gray, did I hear you correctly in your opening statement when you said that John Doyle had never asked for a severance package?
Correct.
So did you never discuss a severance package with John Doyle prior to the Remuneration Committee deliberations on the 28th of January?
No.
You never discussed?
No.
Right, OK. Well, I have a letter here, and the information's coming in by the hour. Now, it's from you, Mr. Gray, and it's to the members of the Remuneration Committee. Having talked to John at some length, it's now clear that John's position in Lanarkshire is becoming even more difficult. We should now agree a severance package with him on that basis. You propose a pay increase of 6%, and you're happy to recommend an arrangement based on 2 years' gross salary, which you would certainly not consider unreasonable. You go on to say, I believe that this will allow the board, the staff and the students to celebrate John's worth and success, and it would allow him to go out on a high without being picked over. So you wrote that to 6 members of the Remuneration Committee. We have the evidence here today. And I thought I was hearing things when I heard you say John had never asked for a severance package. It hadn't been discussed. And you openly admit here in asking for the remuneration to agree to this, to have a meeting, that you've talked with John at some length.
But not about a severance
package.
Not about
a severance package. That is absolutely not in that letter.
You've talked
to John.
We talked
to John about him leaving the college under the circumstances that were on the table. So that was my duty to talk to him about his future with the college, and that's exactly what that letter says. I talked to him about his future.
Right, so he, this is John, now believes the best way forward for all concerned, and bearing in mind there will be only one principal's job, that we should now agree a severance package with him. So you're adamant, despite everything you say in this letter, you never ever discussed a severance package with John Doyle.
Correct.
Right. So who did you discuss the 6% increase in pay, the 2 years' gross salary, the 2 years' gross salary? There was also the pension, which 90,000, which you decided in hindsight not to pay. Did you just come up with all that on your own?
We discussed it with the Remuneration Committee.
No, this is when people. You're asking the this is your letter to the Remuneration Committee, asking for a meeting, and you even give your home phone number, and if you're happy with the proposal that we offer John voluntary service as outlined above, I will of course ask Lorraine to convene a Remuneration Committee meeting. So that was the one on the 28th of January. This is your invitation to the meeting that resulted in John Doyle getting 304,000, well over the recommended guidance by the Scottish Funding Council. This is your letter to the Remuneration Committee to ask them to come to a meeting. And you've put in here the exact terms, which have and no mention of SFC guidance or any others.
SFC guidance were available to all members of the Remuneration Committee.
You never
all
told them
the
that.
They didn't do their homework like
Why
decent people
you,
should do.
Well, you're the chairman. You've written a lengthy letter here. Why didn't you mention the SFC guidance? You say you'd looked at the Edinburgh model. Why didn't you mention that it was well over twice the Funding Council guidance? And before I come to my other questions, we also have a letter from the 6 members of the Remuneration Committee. Happy to read out the names, but I think you're familiar with them. At the 28th of January Remuneration Committee, the SFC guidance was not given to us at the meeting, nor were we signposted to it during or after the meeting. There was no mention of it in the notes of the meeting, and there's no mention of consideration of SFC guidance in any notes. So you misled, in my view, the Remuneration Committee. They did not know anything of the guidance. They thought what they were signing up to in your letter to let John go out on a high and celebrate his worth, they thought they were signing up to something that was statutorily acceptable and accurate. Is that correct?
They did not read the papers that were prepared for that meeting then. Those papers were circulated to them on the internet, which is the way we do our board papers and our committee papers. That was in that circulation. They did not read what was in front of them.
Well, why didn't
they were provided with that information. Okay.
They weren't provided with it.
It was on their computer, it was on their laptop.
There's six members here. They've written to us on the 24th of November. They were not provided. They can't all be wrong. One might have had a wee lapse of memory. They can't all be wrong.
It was in the papers circulated. It was in the papers circulated to them before the meeting.
It wasn't in the papers circulated.
The papers circulated to the meeting are on the board intranet, and that's the way we circulated papers. We didn't provide piles of copies.
Nor
it was all
were
on their laptops.
Nor were we signposted.
Okay, that's
Mrs. Okay. Mrs. Scanlon,
John Gray.
Of course.
Give you a chance in a minute. They can't all be wrong.
Okay.
So are they all lying? Did they all come along here and lie to us?
No, I don't think they did. I think
Well, somebody's wrong. It's either the Remuneration Committee. None of them were signposted. None of them knew anything about the SFC guidance, which was far, far less generous to Mr. Doyle than your recommendation. But you say they did. So someone's wrong. Is it the six members of the Remuneration Committee, or is it you?
Well, you can blame me for perhaps chairing a poor meeting. But they had the papers in front of them.
Well, I can also blame
you. Chose not to, if they chose not to read them, that's their business.
Right, so you come up with a 6% pay increase, 2 years' salary, which is even more than any Edinburgh model. Who did you discuss? How did you come up with this very generous severance package for John Doyle? Who did you discuss that with if it wasn't John Doyle, despite your talk to John at length? So what did you talk to John at length about because his position in Lanarkshire was coming more difficult? If it wasn't a severance package, what was your long talk to him about? Because this letter's all about the severance package.
I talked to John about lots of things, about the business of the college.
Well, why is your opening statement, having talked to John about length, at some length, and you go on and recommend a severance package?
Well, the severance package information was based on, as you've heard as many times, on the package that was, at that stage, as we understood it, the Edinburgh package, what people in Edinburgh were offered and got. It was tabled by South Lanarkshire College as a proposal, agreed, a proposal, that that's what should happen to the four Lanarkshire colleges. And at that point in time, that's when we were talking and meeting. And we, you can say erroneously, if you like, we thought that that's what was going to prevail and that we were happy and the board was happy and the remuneration committee was happy to give John that offer. Okay. He did not concoct that offer himself in any way, shape or form. If I got information, it certainly didn't come off the top of my head. It would come from the HR director who knew and was familiar with all of these sort of schemes that were around the place and being talked about at the time. That's where the information would come from.
Okay, well, in the same letter, which was all about severance package, you start off by saying you've talked to John at some length. So we'll leave it there. We have the evidence here, and that's for our report and for others to look over. So can I just ask, did you say to the Remuneration Committee that the SFC had any objections, or did they have no objections to what was being proposed? What did you tell them?
What I discussed with Mark Bathell was...
No, I'm asking what you discussed with the Remuneration Committee. What did you tell them in relation to the Scottish Funding Council guidance, which you knew all about, mm-hmm. but they didn't? So did you tell them that the Scottish Funding Council had no objections to your generous offer to John Doyle to celebrate his worth?
What we talked about there was my discussion with Mark Bathell, which made clear that if we wished to pay more than the guideline, we were responsible for the additional cost ourselves in the college.
So did Mark Bathell say it's fine to give him a 6% pay rise, it's fine to pay 21 months plus 3 months plus an extra 6 months? Did Mark Bathell say that was fine? Did he endorse that?
It was in the discussion I had with him. Now,
Did he endorse it?
I said at the very beginning, the 6 months payment in lieu of notice has nothing to do with this discussion. It's entirely a contractual matter. John had a contract that said that in it. So I wish you wouldn't keep putting it all together.
It's in your letter here.
It's
an Auditor General's report. So we'd be failing in our duty as a public audit committee if we weren't doing our job robustly here. My second question is for John Doyle. Why didn't you, as the accountable officer, why didn't you inform the internal auditor or instruct the internal auditor to be informed about the severance arrangements and payments until an informal meeting on the 28th of October, 8 months after you got your signed bit of paper from the January meeting?
Well, I spoke, as you've seen from my written submission, to John Gray the next day after the Enumeration Committee. We discussed the role of the internal auditors, and I was aware that the internal auditors would, as always, be... the dialogue would be between the chair of the audit committee and the internal auditors. Now, the internal auditors, as everyone in this room is aware, are appointed by the board and they generally report to the audit committee. Now, my understanding of the internal audit, the audit committee is a separate function from the executive, but it's supported by the executive.
I really don't want a big lecture about this. I only want to know, as accountable officer, why didn't you ensure internal and external audit was aware of your severance package?
Well, I am absolutely convinced that internal auditor were aware of a severance package. It is interesting that the only two people that have not been interviewed by this audit committee are the two internal auditors themselves. Now, I was well aware...
You got that wrong.
We actually called for evidence from the internal audit.
But the internal auditors who were the internal auditors for Coatbridge College did not appear here. There was one of the partners who actually didn't engage.
No, we actually had both.
Well,
With two internal auditors. We can clarify that later.
Yeah, I had not met, to my knowledge, the chap who appeared. I think... You're just about to get some...
The point is, I'm just coming on to my final question, but it was your responsibility as accountant.
I'm going to explain...
It's an important point.
It is an important point. I'm going to explain in detail...
Can you give us an answer?
Yes, as soon as the convener's quite happy that the two internal auditors who engage with at Coatbridge and the
Mr.
board...
Mr. Doyle, just to clarify, we ask the questions and you answer the questions.
Yeah. Well, I'm happy to do so, sir.
I'll come back to you about that later after this meeting. I'll clarify for the record.
My understanding was...
You can please answer the questions.
I'd be delighted to. My understanding was that in January, the internal auditors were engaged with the college as part of the merger programme. I was also aware that the internal auditors... were engaged with the audit committee, chaired by Tom Keenan, in terms of the annual audit programme. I was also very much aware that the internal auditors, with Scott McCreef, who you all found about a couple of weeks ago, had done an extensive due diligence, which front and centre of that was severance package. It was my clear understanding right through that period from January that the internal auditors were not only aware but had been engaging in various forms about severance packages. And if I may, it was also my understanding that Scott McCreef, who did that due diligence, would have been liaising directly with the internal auditors on the action plan. They cannot produce a due diligence report for merger without talking to the internal auditors on what has been progressing within the college. And you're quite right. The very last thing I did in closing down was to meet with the internal auditors just before I left. And that was on the basis of I wasn't happy that Scott McCreef had been advised that they had put all of the costs of the severance package of all of the executive team, including all the on-costs, without the SFC contribution. And I raised that with them. They were well aware, Mrs. Scanlon, the internal audit. And if I may finally refer you to Mr. Brown, who said that the internal auditors were well aware of the severance package,
he had spoken to
either Mr. Gray or Mr. Keenan. Now, I spoke to Mr. Gray, and Mr. Gray will confirm that he didn't speak to the internal auditors, which meant that, as one would imagine, the chair of the audit committee spoke to the internal auditors. So I was aware that the internal auditors had been engaged in the process since January, all the way through. So it is incorrect to say that I did not engage or I wasn't, or in some way held the information back from them. That is not correct.
Well, it's taken you a very long time and a lot of our time to talk all around the awareness and the engagement, but you still haven't answered the question that as accountable officer, you used your responsibility and notified and informed the internal and external auditors, expecting them to be aware and be engaged and all around the shop. The responsibility was yours, and Audit Scotland, the internal and external auditors, were not aware of your severance payments. And I'll leave it there.
I think there's something far wrong there, Mrs. Scanlon. If the internal auditors, having gone through a programme in January right through to October, having engaged with the chair of the audit committee throughout the summer and beyond, the internal auditors, my understanding is, have got a clear duty to protect the board. They were well aware that we were going through a merger programme. They had carried out the similar work with New College, Lanarkshire, Motherwell and Cumbernauld. So it is absolutely erroneous to say...
You were well aware that you should have told them.
I was well aware that they were aware. There was no point in writing separately if they were aware.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Doyle, when you were giving evidence on 28th October, we heard from you that your decision or the events leading up to your decision to leave were as a result of a discussion with a representative of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council. And to quote you, everyone in this room understands the language of power. When you're invited by the Scottish Government and the Funding Council to discuss your leaving early, you know your position is untenable. Now that was, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, in August?
It would have been in August, yes. That was me leaving early, not leaving, yes.
Yeah. And yet, the 28th January Remuneration Committee, the chair presented a letter outlining your untenable position at that point and the package that was around that. Does that not sort of contradict?
Not at all. In the context that there can only be one principal when there's a merger. There were three colleges merging. The chair of the board and the board had obviously decided that they would produce a severance package if required for me. At that point, there was no structures, there were no interviews, there was no interviews on the horizon. So I, after discussion with the chair of the board, as per the SFC guidance, agreed that I would accept that offer. It wasn't until mid-July when the Scottish Government rep and Linda McTavish came to the college and presented, as I've written to you and written evidence on Monday, came to the college and presented the terms and conditions for a merger with what was going to be New College Lanarkshire. And contained within that was the fact that I couldn't apply for the job because the job had been given to Mark Maguire. And I've made that very clear over a number of correspondence with this committee.
Well, clearly the job was given to someone else because Coatbridge College withdrew from the merger at a critical point.
Yes.
Can I just come back to this, to the letter that you were issued with, I think, on the 29th of January? Was there a termination date on that letter?
I haven't looked at it for a couple of years. My understanding is that it was what I would call an enabling agreement in the context of if the date changed from, and forgive me if I get this wrong, whether it was March or 31st of July, I can't remember now, that it would allow me to progress. So if there was a delay in the vesting day, as it's called, the letter would still be intact. So I think it was a continuation date. I don't think there was a fixed date in it.
I mean, other,
but I may be wrong in that. I haven't looked at it for a couple of years.
Other senior members received offer letters that had a termination date of 31st July. And you know, I'm asking, did yours have that same termination date?
From memory, it had a 31st of July, but and I don't want to say and get the words wrong, so if I get the words slightly wrong, but the message from my understanding is, although it's easy enough, check. Have you got a copy of my letter there?
I don't have a copy of your letter.
Oh, right. Well, okay. It would have been helpful then, because...
It would have been.
It would have been. Well, if somebody had asked me, I'd have happily provided a copy of it. I can send a copy this afternoon to the clerk, to the board. I'm sure I've got it in file somewhere. However, to answer your question, Mr. Beery, to answer your question, my understanding, it wasn't a fixed date. It was a date about vesting day, but with agreement by the board, it could be later.
I get a bit confused with some of the terminology used here. I hear these offer letters being referred to as comfort letters. You're talking about them now as being enabling letters.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean it to be an enabling letter. I meant it was within there a flexible date from memory. But I'm happy to send the clerk to the board this afternoon a copy of my letter. I thought you had a copy of it. May I also address the comfort letter? The comfort letter term came from, not from the board of management, I'm sure, but from the fact that people took some comfort in the fact that they had something that enabled them to forget what would happen if they weren't part of the college going forward and get on with the job of moving the college forward towards merger and for the cohort of students that were studying with us. If that helps, that was what I think people meant by a comfort letter, or a letter of comfort.
Can I come back to something you discussed a little while ago, which is in connection with the financial cost of the settlement? You're the accountable officer. Did you discuss with the Director of Finance the affordability of the package?
I spoke to Derek Banks, the Director of Finance, after the 29th. It could have been the same day. It could have been a couple of days later. It was on or around. And we had a financial forecast return. For the 9 years I was the accountable officer, we had very accurate financial forecast return. We were never below it. If we were anything, we were above it. We had 9 years of surpluses. So we spoke in the context of getting our figures right. I explained the conversation I had with the chair of the board.
But you spoke to him about the severance package
I
directly.
Did, yeah. Well, in the detail, just to finish, that... it had been agreed by the Remuneration Committee that the Chair of the Finance Committee, Paul Gilliver, would have an ongoing dialogue with the Director of Finance about affordability. And I understand, both from Paul later on and from Derek, that's exactly what happened.
Well, that's not clear from the evidence given by Paul Brown. As the accountable officer, obviously you have a responsibility, along with the Director of Finance, to ensure that it's affordable and that the college can actually meet that
yes.
financial obligation. Now, clearly, the college couldn't, because at the end of the financial year, they ended up with £1 million deficit. And they quote, partly due to the severance arrangement.
Well, I don't understand how, because if we look at the financial forecast return, you heard a brief from the Director of Finance here, I think it was last week, that we had... or he had included that cost within the forecast. I left on the 31st of October. On the 31st of October, the academic financial year had just begun. We were forecasting a small surplus. We had never been in deficit since I took over in 9 years. I have no idea why we went from a forecast return to £1 million in debt.
It was a severance package.
No, I'm sorry. That was not the case. I haven't looked at the accounts. The last set of accounts I looked at for 12-13 were when I was the accountable officer, and they were as the previous 8 years in first class order. I have no idea. You would need to ask in detail New College Lanarkshire, who took over.
So you're saying it happened after your time?
Absolutely.
Can I ask you about Biggert Bailey?
Yes.
And the remit they had? They do not seem to agree the remit that you indicated during your previous evidence. They seem to believe that they were looking at a very narrow area, and they also said that they were not providing any clerking or other support to the Remuneration Committee?
Yes, I'm happy to clarify that. And it goes back to what I'd said in my statements to this committee, in that I had made an introductory phone call to Paul Brown, which he confirmed. I had conveyed that the chair would wish to speak to him, and it's a matter of wording. I had said that I was looking, because the clerk to the board was ill, for secretariat support. I'd said to my senior team it would be secretariat support. What transpired was it was admin support, and Paul Brown confirmed that. It was on the basis that after I'd made the introductory phone call, I had no engagement. It wasn't at all. So I normally, if you were discussing something with consultants or lawyers, you'd be there and you'd be engaged and you'd follow up. But because I'd only made the introductory phone call, and as Paul Brown has confirmed several times to this committee, my engagement was, look, the chair's going to give you a call, or can you phone the chair? It's about, and we're looking for two things. One of them was, I didn't think such a narrow remit, was to look at all of, as he confirmed last week, all of the processes, documentation and approach by the board on the severance package.
Which he didn't see all the documentation.
Sorry?
He didn't see all the documentation. He made that clear at the...
I'm sorry. I thought he made it very clear that he'd seen it, all the documentation. What documentation, Mr. Beattie, did he not see?
Well, as far as we can understand, he didn't, for example, see the offer letter to yourself.
That's right. The offer letter, I don't understand. There's a copy in my personal file. Surely the external auditor had a copy of that. I don't understand. It's not a secret.
We've been through that area before.
I'm sorry.
The auditors clearly said they had no access to that. They did not see that until much later. But coming back to the question of the role of Biggert Bailey and the scope of what they were looking at, it does seem to be a very narrow area.
I'm not sure what you mean by narrow and how you define narrow in the context of what's missing that you think should have been there.
Well, I think that Biggert Bailey quite clearly did not see all the documentation. They acted on the basis of what they were informed was the situation.
Sorry, Mr. Beattie,
commented on that.
I watched it and read the transcript. They were quite clear that any information that they had asked for, they received, with the exception of the severance letter dated 28th of January.
Yeah.
That was my understanding, and if there's something that I'm wrong on, please tell me.
I think there's probably a little bit of a difference there.
No, I'm happy to. It's a very important point. So if you think there's something missing that Paul Brown didn't get or didn't look at...
Probably the critical thing was the letter, the offer letter to yourself.
And again, I would say it was a letter I thought was in your domain. It was a letter that's in my personal file. It's a letter that Mr. Brown was happy about not seeing. But I'm happy, very happy, to provide the clerk to the board with a copy of that if you don't have it.
I think that would be useful.
Very happy. Actually, can I just finish by saying I thought that you'd asked for it last week, and you would have got that from New College Lanarkshire. I'm sorry, if I'd thought that you're difficult to getting a hold of from New College Lanarkshire, I'd have sent it off to the clerk.
Thank you. Can I just clarify a couple of matters for the record? Firstly, Mr. Doyle, can you confirm that you received an offer letter on the 29th of January 2013 from Mr. Gray?
That's the one we're talking about with Mr. Beattie, yes.
Yes. Can you confirm as accountable officer that you did not speak or contact the Scottish Funding Council in any way regarding that letter thereafter?
In the context, as I've explained, that...
Yes or no will be good enough.
No, I didn't, on the basis of what
I've
explained.
Thank you. Could you then confirm that as accountable officer you did not contact the internal auditor after the 29th of January 2013 regarding, again, the same letter?
Could you repeat that question? Sorry.
Can you confirm that you did not contact the internal auditor after you received that letter on the 29th of January 2013?
I
Yes or no will be good enough.
Yes, I had spoken to the internal auditor, and I spoke to him personally in October.
Did you speak to him after the 29th of January?
No, I didn't speak directly.
So the first time you spoke to him was in October?
Directly about the subject, although
that's
I was...
Fine. Thank you. That's
well,
on the
I think
that's
for the record
helpful.
It's important that's it's
fine.
Well
Can
aware.
Can I now move on to that? No, what, you've given me, you've answered the question. I'm very grateful
fine.
For that. Do you recognise that the Scottish Funding Council's guidance includes the requirement for a business case?
It mentions a business case, yes.
Do you recognise that it includes a requirement for a business case, Mr. Doyle?
Yes.
Thank you. Was there a business case for your severance payment?
My understanding was that there was a business case.
Where is it?
I haven't got, as I've explained, I haven't got any documentation.
So you don't have it, and you never saw it?
The business case was explained to me by the chair of the board who discussed it with the remuneration committee.
But there's no document you can point the committee to which illustrates that business case?
Well, I wouldn't have any documentation for that.
So you couldn't present that to the auditor when you met him in October to discuss this matter?
The internal auditor?
Correct.
When I met the internal auditor...
Can you just answer the question? Did you give the internal auditor a business case in October for your severance package?
I didn't have a business case from the remuneration committee.
So you recognise the guidance said you as accountable officer had to make sure that the funding council, that there was a business case and that did not happen?
The business case in the context that we're talking about was on the remuneration committee discussion and contained within the letter and the detail of that. Now...
Which letter?
The severance letter.
It includes a business case.
Well,
it
includes a rationale for it.
That's not what I'm asking. You said earlier on to the convener that you're very clear about this guidance, the funding council issues. You therefore know what a business case. You're a very experienced principal, or were a very experienced principal. You're now saying there was a rationale. That's not a business case, Mr. Doyle, is it?
When I spoke to the chair on the 29th...
I don't care about what you spoke to. Can you answer the question? Was that a business case or not? Yes.
I understood there was a business case. Yes.
You understood.
Yes.
You understood, but you can't give us any indication of where it is or if it exists, other than in a paragraph in a letter in your letter.
Well, it
that's what you think is the business case.
No, I didn't. I'm sorry, Mr. Scott. I didn't say that. When I spoke,
well, you did actually. That's exactly what you said.
When I spoke to Mr. Gray the day after the remuneration committee, I asked about the affordability, accountability in the context of a business case. They'd said they'd covered all of that. That I didn't get a copy of that business case from
the... But it doesn't exist, Mr. Doyle. It doesn't exist. The minutes don't reflect that. As you've seen the minutes, you know it doesn't reflect
that.
Well,
Paul, Mr. Brown said that there was a business case.
And he can't give us it either.
Oh, right. Okay. So why did he say there was a business case?
Could you stop asking questions? You're here to answer questions,
sir. I'm sorry.
Okay?
Sorry.
There's no business case. Correct. You're the accountable officer... You failed to alert the funding council, you failed to alert the internal auditor, and you failed to ensure there's a business case. Is
no,
that
I,
not three I, clear failings as
no,
you
I,
as accountable
I, I'm
officer?
Sorry, Mr. Scott, I disagree. The funding council were aware. There was no need for me to make them aware because
yes, there
the chair...
is, because it's in the guidance that you claim to know about. There is an absolute requirement on you as accountable officer to make the funding council aware of the letter you got on the 29th of January with your severance payment in it, £304,000 of public money. You should have then phoned the funding council or contacted them to say that letter had been received, shouldn't you? That's what the guidance says.
No, my understanding was that was taken care of by the long conversation that John Gray had with Mark Bathill.
You can understand all you like. Read the guidance, Mr. Doyle. It is very clear what it says, isn't it?
Well, I haven't read the guidance for a while, but if you say that...
I have no further questions.
Yes, I have to say, having served on a university court for 9 years and chaired a charity as well, I'm interested in the charitable side of this. Were you both trustees in that respect, in the charitable side? Did you act as... you were acting as trustees of the Coatbridge charity
You're
as well as...
me.
Both of you. Were both of you...
Well, directors, directors of college boards are by definition trustees of the charity. Each college is a charity.
So
we're all trustees.
Did the board at any point have a discussion about the charitable side of these significant payments being made? No.
No.
You're shaking your head, but we need it on verbal for the record. Mr. Doyle, no?
No.
No, so there was no discussion of the effect, your responsibilities as trustees in relation to the charity. I want to go back to this letter, the meeting of the 28th and the letter of the 29th. I have to say, in my experience, I have never, ever heard of a major decision being communicated to the individual who is affected by that decision within 24 hours of a committee without the committee actually approving the minutes. And I find that really quite interesting, and I'd like to know from you, Mr. Gray, as to why you felt it necessary without the committee actually approving those minutes. And you'll remember there was some dispute about them when it came to the 23rd of October, that that you actually felt it necessary to rush this into a letter, which we haven't seen, of course, but this severance letter to Mr. Doyle, and get his reply. Well, we'll come to Mr. Doyle's response, but you sent that letter within 24 hours of the meeting. Why?
Each time I visit the college involves me in 130 miles round trip. I happened to be in Coatbridge the following day following the committee meeting. The letter was there. It had to be signed by me, so I signed it. It wasn't done because it was just the next day or there was no haste involved necessarily. It was a convenience for me to be there at the time, and I signed it on that basis. The dispute, can I just say, the dispute about the discussion at the Remuneration Committee concerned not John Doyle's package, but the package that might have prevailed for senior managers, which at the end of the day did not prevail and was withdrawn. So the Remuneration Committee, as far as I'm concerned, in the minutes and in future meetings, were content with the amount that John Doyle was to be paid. And by the way, 40% of that goes straight back into the public purse via the Inland Revenue.
Well, I think that, yes, I don't think that's particularly relevant.
Maybe not.
So you, after, immediately after the meeting on the 28th, you dictated a letter, which was then typed up.
Yes.
And you signed it the next day because you happened to be in. You didn't think that this was such an important decision that you should actually get the minutes signed off before proceeding with such a major decision that was out with the guidance which you were aware of from the Scottish Funding Council.
I had the verbal agreement of the Remuneration Committee that they were happy with what was being offered to John.
And did you have the agreement of the Funding Council?
The Funding Council, previously, my meeting with Mark Batho, as I said earlier, we discussed the guideline, and his advice to me was that, yeah, if you guys want to pay more, and this is relevant to other colleges as well, if you want to pay more, be clear that we will only refund you the guideline amount.
Right, but there was no objection from Mr. Ratho that you were paying.
No, there was no red line.
Okay, that's fine. Now, the other bit of that is that the additional money being paid out and the severance letter, Mr. Brown told us that when he drafted the severance agreement, which he apparently must have, I presume he did on your instructions, he claims that he hadn't actually seen the severance letter.
I can't answer that.
Where the business case to which Tavish Scott, my colleague, referred, that business case was presented to the Remuneration Committee?
I get a bit thrown by this business case question. There isn't a piece of paper that says business case at the top of it. I think we discussed the implications in a business fashion as to what was being offered, what the implications were, etc., and what the justifications were.
Under the Nolan guidance, I mean, far less the Scottish Funding Council guidance, I mean, Nolan was set up because of scandals in relation to various things occurring within businesses over the years. Mm-hmm. And Nolan said that if you actually were going to make significant payments to someone, you had got to present a business case to justify that. Now, that's Nolan. Scottish Funding Council creates it very clear that you were required to do that. And the Oscar Charitable Guidance makes it very clear that if you're spending charitable funds, which you were, then you are required to actually present a comprehensive case as to why you're doing this, because you're required to justify to the public and to Oscar the use of public money, far less to us and to the taxpayers. So on every issue where the requirements were there, you As an experienced person, and I've seen your CV, very experienced individual in business, you were not aware that you were required, not to produce a rationale or some discussion about it, but you were required to produce a firm business case. And you didn't do so.
Correct.
Okay, that's fine. And Mr. Doyle, as the accounting officer, accountable officer, you were also required to ensure, in terms of those three elements that I've just mentioned, you were required to produce a firm business case for any significant expenditure within the college that was out with normal guidance, and you did not do so.
That's correct.
Thank you. Okay, well, that that makes that all very, very clear. Thank you.
Morning.
I'm very grateful that we've now established that there is no piece of paper with business case written at the top of it. That's very helpful. I'd like to come back, Mr. Gray, to your comments about your proposal in that email to the committee, the Remuneration Committee, before they had the meeting in January, where you suggested terms which clearly were very generous and may well have reflected your own view about what Mr. Doyle had done. I'd like to return to the question now. Perhaps you've had a little while to think about it, about who did you discuss that with before you actually came up with those terms which we've just heard about?
Well, the terms are based on, as we've said several times, what was initially called the Edinburgh case, and then the proposal that went to the Federation Board of the Lanarkshire Colleges. That was entirely an independent proposal that, as far as Coatbridge was concerned, we felt capable. We thought that's what the game plan was for the sector at that time.
But
and that's what we decided to go with.
Right.
And
forgive
that's
me.
What John Doyle got offered.
Yes, but I'm trying to work out who the we was before you wrote that letter to your colleagues. Was it just you, or who did you discuss?
Certainly not just me. I mean, I'm not the fount of all wisdom. The HR director would be involved, and I can't say for certain, because I can't remember all the details of the discussions that go on round about these subjects, because you talk to people all the time about things.
Yep.
I'm pretty certain I would mention it and discuss it with members of the Remuneration Committee, but I can't prove that.
So your proposal to them, ahead of the suggestion that there should be a meeting to agree it, would already have been discussed with, for example, at least the HR director?
Yes, I would say so. Yes, definitely.
If we then go to the meeting in January, you have just told us quite animatedly that the members of the committee didn't do their homework if they didn't know about the guidance from the SFC. Would it not be your job as the chair of that meeting, never mind the chair of the board, to make sure that that discussion is held, and therefore to raise the issues rather than just to go down one tack?
I think clearly with the hindsight and what was said and what was minuted, I did not draw that to the attention of the committee. And that can be a failure on my part as chair and a poor performance on my part. But there's certainly no intent behind that.
No. Okay, so we could reasonably draw the conclusion that the discussion at that remuneration committee was around your proposal. I take the point that it was not specifically about Mr. Doyle, but it was senior management in general. I think I've heard that. But it is perfectly reasonable to draw the conclusion that there was no comment whatsoever about the SFC guidelines.
Obviously not at the meeting, because the minutes are quite clear about that. But it doesn't mean to say that the committee were not aware of that, because they had that in their papers for the meeting. I didn't draw their attention to it, but it was there. And if they cared to read the papers, which I would assume committees generally do read the papers they get presented with.
Yes, some of us do. Clearly some don't. That may be. What was the purpose then of a conversation with Mark Batho shortly beforehand if what he said was not going to be taken into account?
I think the discussion with Mark Batho was to try and fulfil our obligations in terms of making sure the funding council knew what we were doing, which I think is part of what you're all talking about. And as far as I'm concerned, I saw him and I know him of old. I've known him for a long time. We had a very level discussion. He laid out what the score was, and I told him what we were proposing. And he said, well, that's up to you. If you want to do that, that's... but you have to meet the cost.
Indeed. Okay. We've then just had a discussion about the letter which followed very shortly after which Mr. Doyle was given and signed. We've had some helpful discussion about whether there might have been a date on it, which is news this morning. My understanding from previous evidence is that any letters that were sent to other senior managers, no doubt just a little bit later, included the same severance date of around the 31st of July. I think that's the date we're working on. What I'd like to understand is why it is that in Mr. Doyle's case, that seemed to matter, sorry, not to matter, because Mr. Brown came to the conclusion that you had to be, your agreement had to be honoured, whereas other senior managers who must have received very similar letters with the same severance date could have their offer withdrawn.
Well,
what's,
I can
what's the difference between those two offers, please?
I can't say there's a difference, but I can tell you the story, or I can tell you the facts behind the offers to the senior managers being withdrawn, because I was involved in that.
Well, okay, I guess my question is not directly that, but what's the difference between that and Mr. Doyle's position when he would apparently have been sent a similar letter in similar terms?
All I can say is that Mr. Doyle's offer stood for whatever reason. I think the board were happy with it. They, as I've said in my opening remarks, nobody ever questioned the value of that package, guidelines or no guidelines. And nobody suggested at any point that it should be stopped, withdrawn, adjusted or amended. They were all content to sign on to that agreement and for it to proceed.
Which of you then decided that on the 11th of October we'd have to get a settlement agreement signed so that Mr. Brown knew that it was a fait accompli?
I'm not sure that's entirely accurate, Mr. Don. I was given, well, as Mr. Brown has said, I was working my notice at that point. I had a couple of weeks to go. There was a pay run due. I had to sign a settlement agreement, which I had to go to the lawyer. There was due process taking place. As an employee, I was leaving in a matter of weeks. I was given a letter and a settlement agreement to pass through my lawyer, which I did. And I signed that roughly about the 10th of October. A couple of weeks before I was due to go.
Which would coincidentally be the point at which Mr. Brown is engaged to make sure that the board gets the advice that this contract is different.
Mr. Brown was engaged by the chair and the board on the basis that we had received a communication from the Funding Council and Scottish Government about, as Mr. Martin had said, two severance schemes being in existence.
Thank you, Convener. Just it's regarding the meeting on the 28th of January, once again. And in terms of the papers that we have received, certainly for this meeting, there's the letter that we received signed by the former Coatbridge Remuneration Committee members. In that letter, it states that regarding the paperwork that was available for the committee, it states that the email link took members to a specific part of the intranet where the associated papers and documents were located and was not focused on any other part of the site unless specifically directed to go there. On some occasions, the documents were attached to the email message for convenience. Also goes on to say that it was never intended to use intranet as the means of communication of important information. Or to replace raising issues and discussion at meetings held in the college, but as a means of quickly and efficiently disseminating documents for discussion at the appropriate meeting. Now, regarding the information concerning the SFC guidance, clearly, as we've heard today, and also in the minutes regarding that meeting, there is no reference to the guidance in the minutes, and certainly from what we've heard today, it wasn't discussed at that particular meeting. And as you said as well today, Mr. Gray, that in terms of members of the committee, if they didn't look at all the paperwork, then obviously that's their responsibility and not so much yourselves. However, on an issue of such importance, would it not have been beneficial and essential, some would argue, for reference to the SFC guidelines to have been clearly stated in the minutes that were issued to all of the Remuneration Committee members, as compared to that information just being on the intranet and expecting members to actually go and search for it themselves?
The intranet, can I just clarify that? For quite a long time, we introduced the iPad and the intranet as a means of communicating papers to the board members. So for every board meeting, the papers were circulated on that net, on that way. We did that to cut down costs. We saved £7,500 a year by not having to churn out piles of paperwork that we sent round to all the board members. So the process of using the computer and the intranet is an integral part of the board process. Just leave it at that. We didn't, I mean, you're quite right. I did not specifically point the committee at the SFC guideline. Could I just fast forward a bit if this is answering the question?
Okay, and then we may come back, okay?
At the point in time when we had the 23rd of October minutes of the Remuneration Committee and the board, all of that was absolutely abundantly clear to everybody around the table, what the limitations were, what the implications were, and nobody demurred from that. And as far as I'm concerned, at that point, okay, it's a bit after the original offers and all that sort of stuff, but time moves on, and what, as far as I'm concerned, is important is what the final situation was for everybody. And we know that the senior managers were happy, well, not to say they were happy, but they withdrew their requirement and were happy to go along with the single scheme for Lanarkshire colleges. And John was happy to go along with his thing, and you might say, why not? But nobody demurred from that agreement or questioned it or in the light of all the guidelines and everything else that was on the table at that time.
Right, okay, we'll all go back to the 28th. Because clearly, also, there was no link provided to the guidelines to the members.
Okay.
And also, the guidelines have been there since the year 2000. In terms of the use of iPads and laptops and all and the intranet system, then also, there will have been, I would imagine, a fair amount of paperwork allocated for that particular meeting. Surely it would have been advantageous for all concerned if specific points and specific areas would have been highlighted or links would have been provided prior to the meeting when the agenda and papers were being issued, so that all members could easily have access to that particular piece of information, as compared to the expectation that they will have actually go and look for it themselves. Bearing in mind also that these were busy people as well, and they may not have had the time to actually go and attempt to search for this particular information.
Well, I mean, it's a statement of the obvious, quite frankly, that had it been spelled out in words of one syllable, that would have been a lot clearer.
I think that's unfair, because certainly as a member of this committee and a member of this parliament, we receive huge amounts of paperwork and huge amounts of information, and particularly regarding this inquiry that we are undertaking. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can see that's just some of the paperwork that we have actually received for this. So, and it can be advantageous if specific points and specific paperwork is actually highlighted. It ensures that we, as members of this committee, would go and look at it. And I would imagine for the same for other committees in this parliament, also outside of this parliament, for people to be directed to make sure that is an important piece of information, you make sure you look at that.
Well, I accept the comment for clearly, but some people are more thorough than others, and maybe we should play to the lowest common denominator, which is spell it all out in piles of paperwork. I'm happy to admit that I did not spell out the guidelines at that Remuneration Committee meeting.
And I think looking back, okay, that's something that should have been done and I didn't do it. But I think, to me, in the fullness of time, it all got overtaken by events. And so I regret that that meeting could have been better, but following meetings were better. And everybody understood what all the rules were.
Okay. Well, secondly, in terms of the actual package that was discussed on the 28th, and also the signing off of that package on the 29th. Now, was that package, I'm just a bit unclear on this, but was that package designed because at that particular point in time, Coatbridge College was in the merger discussions? And then obviously the college then came out of those discussions later on. So if that was the case, then surely that package should have been withdrawn and then a separate or a different severance package then issued.
Well, I don't think it's as black and white as that, to be perfectly honest. I think there was the activity between the merger process and Coatbridge being in and out and in and out, as you've rightly identified. The whole of that process was part of the merger activity. We were trying desperately to make sure that Coatbridge got proper representation in the merger. We weren't getting any satisfaction in that because we were being told by Motherwell and Cumbernauld, once they had merged, well, if you want in, you do what we tell you and you'll take what you get. That was basically the thing. So there was a lot of heat and anxiety, particularly on my part, to make sure that the staff at Coatbridge College got proper representation. And so I think, looking back over the whole period, sure, things could have been handled differently, papers could have been more freely available, etc. But it doesn't mean to say that people did not know what was going on.
Okay. Not sure. Yeah. I have just one final question. It's on the business case situation. We're aware of Mr. Doyle offering an 18-month severance package in February 2013 to a member of staff in his office without a business case and without the authority to do so. Was it common practice for severance packages or enhanced packages to be offered to people without business cases? Two examples.
What actually happened was the member of staff post was associated with mine. After I had received the offer from the board, on the basis that my post was, if we merged, was going to be lost, I looked at the member staff's contract, which was a separate contract, and I produced a short business case which was put in their file, which gave the rationale and the costs, etc., for that business case. What should have happened, as you've heard from Mrs. Docherty, the chair of the HR committee of the board, was that it was standard operating procedure that I would normally brief the board on any aspect appertaining to that, which I fully intended to do. Unfortunately, I had a very severe accident in May with a lot of facial reconstruction, and I was off for a considerable period of time. And I missed that set of committee meetings, and that didn't happen, and I take full responsibility for missing that link in the chain. It wasn't deliberate. It was on the basis of best employment practice, and as I say, it would have normally been picked up, as Mrs. Docherty has explained, in the HR committee cycle. But I was very ill at the time.
Thank you, Convener. Can I go back to Richard Simpson's earlier point about charitable stage of Coatbridge College, and both you and Mr. Gray being trustees? Can I quote here from evidence from Oscar? Although it might have been within the Remuneration Committee's powers to make a payment, I expect all charitable trustees to think hard about whether such payments would be actively in the charity's interest, because that is one of our duties under charity law. Could I ask Mr. Doyle, Mr. Gray, as trustees, how can you justify the use of charitable assets to pay for Mr. Doyle's enhanced payment?
Well, if I'm happy to kick off if that helps. We were one of the last colleges to merge. As you've heard several times, the Edinburgh College model was the original model and the original severance package. My understanding I may be wrong, but my understanding was quite clear at the time that college funds could be used to support severance packages above and beyond. And that had been, I think, demonstrated in the Edinburgh model, or the Edinburgh Colleges merger. That was my understanding.
As trustees of a charity, do you not have a moral obligation as trustees to use these charities' assets to their best use rather than enhanced payments?
I think we've demonstrated, certainly my tenure, in the 9 years I was the college principal, that we had done that above and beyond, creating alternate income sources, developing the college estate, developing the college student learning experience, and every year producing a surplus against a backdrop of many colleges having a deficit. Our accounts came to this committee every year. Our accounts were unqualified every year, and the college continued to grow.
So you believe you fulfilled your duty as a trustee, as a charity?
In the context that I think you're saying, yes.
Thank you.
Questions, start with Mary Scanlon.
I'd actually like not to talk about the money just for a minute, although we all know that you got £304,000, Mr Doyle. Do you accept, as the accountable officer and principal of the college, that you had a duty of care to all of your staff? And can I just say, in that context, we have the Linkston, the committee's been provided with the Linkston report in recent days. I'll be very brief, convener.
I'm sorry, I haven't read it.
Well, I can tell you what's
okay.
In it. Poor governance and decision-making, which appear to have had a cumulative and negative impact on senior staff. Certain decisions, practices and behaviours fell short of what I would expect in a well-governed college. Now, you were both in charge of that college. We're not likely to see you in front of us again. Can I, Mr Doyle and Mr Gray, give you this opportunity to apologise for your poor governance, your lack of a duty of care to the other members of staff? We know that you're happy with your payoff and everything. Would you like to apologise to the other members of staff at Coatbridge College who also faced the same uncertainty about their future as you did? Would you like to apologise for taking so much money, £304,000, and would you like to apologise to the other members of staff at the college that you failed in your duty of care to them?
In the first instance, Mrs Scanlon, you're raising an aspect of a report that I have not had the opportunity to read.
Well, I've read it
and
to you.
And you've based, I presume, those questions on that report. Now, I would also like to just remind everybody that we left on the 31st of October. The college went on until the 31st of March. My understanding, but I've not read the report, is that covers the whole period after, including and after we left.
I'm giving you a chance to apologise.
So I'm not sure in the context of what you're saying. Are you asking me to apologise because I accepted a severance package that was legal and appropriate? I was losing a job that I loved, that I was very successful in. I was losing 5 years' salary and 7 years'
you,
pension.
It's all about you, Mr Doyle. I'm asking about
your context,
staff. They faced the same issues as you faced. Did you fail in your duty of care to all the staff that you were responsible
for?
No,
I most certainly did not. What did happen was that there was a change in severance policy which reduced for all of those staff from potential 21 months to a maximum of 13 months. I did not introduce that change of severance policy. I would have liked to have seen, as was the board's stated intent.
So you're content that as principal, leave the money aside, that you fulfilled your duty of care to every member of staff at that college?
Is there an example?
I'm asking you.
Well, unless you can give me an example where I didn't.
I'm asking, did you fulfill your duty of care?
Yes, the answer
you
is
did.
Unequivocally
okay,
yes.
Topic that the same report says the cumulative effect of these events, and in my view, the manner in which the senior team had operated and been led under the outgoing principal, appear to have caused the senior management team to collapse, resulting in a team of seven being reduced to two, It's difficult to come to any further conclusions on the specific impact upon senior staff of these matters, given the reasons for the absence of some of the senior staff was not objectively assessed for the occupational health as required under the Coatbridge rules. You've made it clear you haven't seen this report, that would be seem to me to make it clear that they believe that the way in which you acted contributed to the problems after you left of the senior team effectively collapsing from 7 to 2.
Well, there was one member of staff off who was the director of HR, and she was off through stress, which had nothing to do with me. It was the relationship, as she's told you, with the board. Other members of staff were sick after I had left. We had, under no circumstances, a poor management team. The college had been highly successful because of the hard work and professionalism of the senior team. We'd all gone through extensive leadership training. There were no issues at all in terms of the awards that we won every year and continue to win. I don't recognise the description of a senior management team being led. Every single thing that we did within the college was well received by students and staff. And I'm sorry, I don't understand why someone would say that there was a problem with leadership. I left on the 31st of October. My senior management team were not happy because they were very unsure of their future. But that future was not dependent, unfortunately, and I mean unfortunately, on Mr. Gray and myself.
Oh, thank you. I mean, I think just for the record and for balance, it says at the end in bold type in this section, whilst it's true to say that Coatbridge had many successes to be proud of, there was nonetheless weaknesses in government and leadership which had a negative impact at a key moment in their evolution. So just to put that on the record.
Thank you, Mayor. Would you agree that funds from any source coming into the college were charitable funds?
I think the answer to that's clearly yes, because the charity is the college. Anything coming in is part of that.
I would agree with that. And yet we're being told that the resources that the college were going to put against Mr. Doyle's severance package came from commercial work and not from public funds. But frankly, well, it doesn't matter. It's all charitable monies.
I would agree with that totally. I think what you've got to also agree is that the college, over many years, as John has said, raised significant additional funds, call them charitable or anything you like, but additional funds beyond those funds given to us by the government.
Yeah, but Mr. Doyle wasn't operating on a commission basis.
No, and those funds were ploughed back into the college for the advantage of staff, students and everything. So I quite agree with all of that.
The main thing is you accept that it was all charitable funds.
Yes.
Can I ask you, Mr. Gray, do you believe that the money that was paid to Mr. Doyle was compensation for constructive dismissal? To be fair, I've got an email in front of me here from you in which you refer to that.
I actually used the word constructive dismissal.
You did. Compensation for constructive dismissal.
Well, I think if you want to argue the point, I could say yes, it was constructive because he was not given any opportunity to apply for a job in the new college. So he was out of a job through no fault of his own, and that was the end of that.
So in your mind, it was compensation for constructive dismissal?
Well, call it constructive dismissal, termination, whatever. I mean, you can play with all sorts of words you like. He was out of a job through no fault of his own as a direct result of the government's policy in college mergers.
And Mr. Doyle, did you sign a compromise agreement?
I signed a settlement agreement, which was standard operating procedure for the college.
On which date was that?
It would have been around the 11th, 12th, 13th, something like that, October.
So it was early in October?
It was about mid-October.
And yet we've got a letter here from, at least an email from Pauline Doherty, referring to the fact that you will be signing a compromise agreement. Did you ever sign a compromise agreement?
I think there's some confusion again in the language, and I fully understand why. Mr. Brown last week was talking about settlement agreements. I think he was asked the question on compromise settlement, and I thought he clarified it, that the settlement agreements that were used were there to protect the institution, not to in any way stop people, for example here, talking about what happened. It was there as a standard agreement that all staff signed from the principal down when they were leaving the college. It wasn't meant to, in any shape or form, stifle anyone's discussion at things like this.
Can I just ask finally, Mr. Gray, you referred to earlier, and I think as a recognition of your humility, you recognised that perhaps you could have signposted the committee more effectively in the information that you provided to them. And specifically, we referred to the business case, which there doesn't appear to have been any business case. Now, do you not feel let down by that? I mean, do you not feel that information that should have been provided to you should have been clear? You should have been briefed on what you should have provided to the committee by Mr. Doyle? And you've shown a bit of humility earlier and says, look, maybe I've got some of this wrong. Maybe I should have, in hindsight, provided more information to the board. So, you know, let us recognise that here as a committee, that humility, at least on that issue, maybe not on others, but has been shown. So do you recognise that you could have been better supported through this process?
Well,
because it's not your responsibility to provide a business case. Somebody needs to provide that to you. As you said, you're not paid to be the chairman of the board.
Mm-hmm.
You said that you make a 120-mile round trip to get to the board. So obviously you're a committed individual who wants to do this because they want to better the college. So should you not have been provided with the appropriate material so that you could be briefed by the accountable officer?
I think sitting here today and looking back,
yeah,
and it's a great thing, hindsight.
No, absolutely.
And we could argue a lot of the cases that you're asking about should have been handled better. And I would admit to that totally.
So do you not look back in that and say, Mr. Doyle, tell you what, I went into that board meeting, I had to make these very important decisions. I now know that you were the accountable officer. You shouldn't have been able to excuse yourself from at least ensuring that I had objective and information before me properly for me to be able to take this decision. Mr. Doyle, that was your responsibility because you've shown humility. You've came to here in public and said, yeah, I could have got some of this right in hindsight. I should have done this, I should have done that. But should Mr. Doyle have been placed in that position as well? After all, he was paid for it. You weren't. Well, let's not look at Mr. Doyle. Let's be clear,
as far as I'm concerned...
I'll come to Mr. Doyle in a second.
Over the years, John was there 9 years during my whole period of chairmanship.
You were let down, though.
I had a very good working relationship.
Yeah, we understand that, yeah.
And we discussed all things to do with the college on a regular basis. If there were weaknesses in this particular respect, I didn't see them. I thought we were carrying out our responsibilities in a proper, responsible fashion.
But I understand that, Mr. Gray, and I respect that. But now you look back in it and you say, I'll tell you what, John, you could have done a bit more for me here. You could have really ensured that I was in a position of being able to take this decision, ensure everyone was briefed accordingly, because I'll tell you what, I don't want to be placed in this position. I've got a career in private enterprise over the years. As Richard Simpson says, there's been a good CV here. And this is an unblemished career for me. I've went into this in I'm a charity trustee. Why have you done this to me? Have you not had that conversation?
No.
But you should have, though, should you not? You know, in reflection?
You can see that.
Okay, so Mr. Doyle, do you not feel that you've let Mr. Gray down?
I think, as Mr. Gray said, in hindsight, when one picks over all of the various detail, including the access to the guidance by the board members, which was there, it was easily found, and that's where I got my copy of the guidance. Of course, hindsight is a great tool, and none of us would have wanted to be here looking at in detail errors that have been made
or omissions.
So you
accept there were some failures then?
On the basis, absolutely, there were omissions and...
So can I just ask you the final question then? Why not pay back the £304,000? Why not pay it back and let's start again with an objective process and do what we should have done at the outset? That would allow you to then make the case that, yes, I should have been paid £304,000, it would allow the board who are there now to make that decision properly and formally. So why don't you pay the £304,000 back, Mr. Martin, Doyle?
If I had been an opportunity to be at the college, I wouldn't be in this position. I left a successful career through no fault of my own. I lost 5 years' salary and a much reduced pension.
I'm asking you, though. Why not rewind? If I can ask the minister, can we rewind? And she says, yeah, we can see what we can do. If Mr. Doyle wants to pay the money back, we'll allow a proper due diligence process to be followed, and then we can go forward. And then perhaps the committee could make that recommendation. Would you not go for that process?
No, I wouldn't go for that process on the basis of what I've just said. I lost a successful career through no fault of my own.
I'm not talking about your career. I'm talking about the fact that you've let Mr. Gray down. You haven't provided them with the objective information as the accountable officer. Do you not feel that this man, who's in an unblemished career, he's been in private enterprise, says he travels 120 miles to get to the college, doesn't get paid for it. You're saying that somebody has received £304,000, you're not willing to rewind and ensure that we get a proper process in place.
I'm very willing to rewind in the context of lessons learned.
Should you not be ashamed that you're not willing to at least rewind and look at this and have a proper objective process and allow this man to for his career to be looked at again?
Mr. Martin, I lost my job through no fault of my own.
Absolutely.
I lost an income source. I have no other income source apart from my reduced pension. I feel, in the context of an employee let down, I feel in the context of a principal and a chief exec that we could have got things better, absolutely, because in hindsight, it would have been watertight. They would have been signing in blood for that they understood the guidance, as Mr. Brown had said several times that the enumeration committee understood the guidance. And the business case would have not have been produced by the remuneration committee, as it was explained to me the next day, but it would have been done in context with
executive.
So in short,
you won't pay the money back?
There is no reason for me to pay the money back.
Yeah, so you won't be paying it back?
Mr.
Gray, do you think you should pay it back?
No.
Okay. Can I just confirm, just for the record, that Alistair Gray attended the committee from Wiley and Bissett, and I understand that he was responsible. He made it clear to the committee that he was responsible for the overview, but he wasn't, as you confirmed, Mr. Doyle, the auditor who was personally responsible for the college. But in saying that, we were provided with an overview of responsibilities.
I think, sir, it's very important in terms of the internal audit function that the two internal auditors who operated the college and worked directly to the audit committee and the chair of the audit committee weren't questioned. You didn't have an opportunity to ask them about those.
I think what's important, Convener, is that the internal auditor was not told by Mr. Doyle on the 29th of January 2013 that he had entered into that severance arrangement. Exactly. That's what's important.
Except, sir, there were seven.
Could you just clarify, Mr. Doyle, in terms of how we go about the information that needs to be signposted to us? We'll take advice from the clerks on that, and not from you, if you don't mind.
No, of course.
I think there's a number of issues about how information has been signposted for the board that you're responsible for, so let us deal with that, and we can deal with how we pursue further information. That's a responsibility of the committee. Can I thank you both for your time this morning, and can move the committee into a brief 5-minute interval.
Thank you.
Good morning, colleagues. May I now welcome our second panel of witnesses today, who are Angela Constance, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, and Aileen McKechnie, who's the Director of Advanced Learning and Science, the Scottish Government. I understand that Angela Constance would like to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. And can I start by saying I very much welcome the committee's scrutiny of the voluntary severance arrangements of the former Coatbridge College. This is rightly a matter of considerable public interest. We must understand the detail of what happened so that there is no repetition. And fundamentally, this is about a failure of governance. My College Governance Task Group will take full account of the committee's report on Coatbridge and also its previous report on North Glasgow College, and I chaired the first meeting of that task group last week, Convener. And this group will move swiftly and will produce recommendations early in the new year. Now, our college reform had three priorities: learner and employer needs, value for money, and stronger accountability. We wanted a regional structure, colleges of scale and influence, delivering coherent quality provision. And mergers meant that there would be voluntary redundancies. With the Scottish Funding Council, we found funding to help that process. As a result, we now have a sector generating significant efficiency savings year on year. Improving standards of governance was central to our reforms. In 2011, we commissioned an independent review led by Professor Griggs. He concluded that the structure and governance of the sector, as was then, was not fit for purpose. In particular, Professor Griggs said that college governance needed greater public accountability, consistent with the evidence and the investment that we make in it. The events at Coatbridge reinforced the case for improving governance. The way in which decisions were made was appalling. Those entrusted with the stewardship of public funds fell well short of what is required. The Funding Council has set out the action it took consistent with the guidance at the time. It does acknowledge it could have been more proactive, and that is something that my task group will consider along with early warning mechanisms. But we have to recognise the position has now already changed, and markedly so. The Auditor General has confirmed that the new controls are much more robust. Before reclassification, decisions on severance were the sole responsibility of colleges, taking into account Funding Council guidance. Following reclassification in April 2014, incorporated colleges must now seek approval from the Funding Council for severance and settlement arrangements. Doing so is a term and condition of grant, and ministers now have more explicit powers to remove incorporated college boards for serious or repeated breaches of those terms and conditions. The Funding Council's forthcoming guidance will reinforce this and the process that colleges must follow. Convener, the committee's report on Coatbridge College will help inform that guidance also. So the essential elements of good governance and improvement are in hand. This is as it should be. Colleges are delivering for students. Our key indicators are improving, and the overwhelming majority are well led and well governed. But all colleges need to be led and governed to high standards, and through my task group and other relevant work, I will ensure that we have greater confidence in the required standards and to ensure that those required standards are met across the sector. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, I just open questions. Can I firstly just rewind this, your statement where you said you found the governance arrangements to be appalling, is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So do you think that Mr Doyle should pay back the £304,000?
As I said, Convener, am appalled at the poor governance and the lack of stewardship, and I of course would, if I could, rewind the situation to ensure that payments in excess of £300,000, which were completely exorbitant, that those payments were not met from the public purse. It is clear to me that there has been a lack of stewardship of public funding. And of course, I would want Mr. Doyle to pay back money that he has received at the expense of the public purse. Whether there is a mechanism to do that is, of course, a different question.
But just from a personal point of view, as the Cabinet Secretary, you think that Mr. Doyle should pay back £304,000?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And in terms of the position that he advises of the Funding Council, he advises that they could have been more proactive. Is that Lawrence Hills that's advising you that? Or is that your opinion?
That's my opinion, Convener.
Could you give me two examples of where you think they could have been more proactive?
Well, when I look at the timeline of events, I can see that the Funding Council issued the guidance on severance at the start of 2013, and that's right and proper. And when I look at that timeline of events that committee has been studying very carefully, I see that the decision in terms of payments made to the former principal were made at the beginning of the year. Yet, sight of that decision was not evident till much later on in the year, in terms of October. So what I'm keen that my task force looks at is what would be reasonable for the Funding Council to do proactively. You know, what more could have been done realistically? And I know much of this is with the benefit of hindsight. And I think while it's right and proper that, you know, the guidance was issued, but should there have been follow-up procedures to ensure that that guidance was getting to the right people?
Yeah, but let's be clear here, though. Mike Russell announced a decision which received political support for the college mergers. So it would have been no surprise to Mike Russell or any minister that, yeah, we're going to have voluntary severance packages. And yes, they must have seen the possibility of colleges taking advantage or college principals possibly taking advantage of that, those arrangements have been put in place. Mm-hmm. So did Mike Russell not say, you know, I'm really concerned about this, I want to have a consistent scheme across the board, and I'll tell you what, I'll also make a point to every one of you, if you don't adhere to these, then we'll not make the payments. Because for these schemes to be successful, they required Scottish Government funding. So why not just tell them that and say, we're just not going to give you the money when you try and draw it down. Because we've had there's been Funding Council officials who have, you know, advised after, for example, Mr. Doyle's case, when do we arrange payment? We've got an email exchange between Mr. Kemp and Derek Banks, the Director of Finance at Coatbridge College, making the necessary arrangements for the money to be drawn down from the Scottish Funding Council after Mr. Doyle's been paid out. So there seems to be a pretty relaxed attitude to the fact that, yeah, you can make your own arrangements, we'll pay our share, but anything above that has to come out of somewhere else.
Yeah. Well, my predecessor, Mr. Russell, and senior civil servants, and indeed the Funding Council, were clear about the conditions and expectations around the use of strategic funds that were to be made available to support voluntary severance schemes. And the detail of that was that payments were not to be in excess of a year's salary or 12 months' salary. Mr. Russell had been very clear that there needed to be restraint. One of the very deeply disappointing aspects of this appalling set of affairs around Coatbridge College was that there was a different severance scheme for the principal compared to other members of staff.
But that happened in other colleges as well, didn't it?
Yeah, and it shouldn't be. Well,
it's not just Coatbridge we're talking about here. We've got details of other colleges.
more than aware that the Auditor General has pointed to isolated examples of poor governance and poor practice around severance, and that she has made two Section 22 reports. Now, the fact that she's had to make two reports on isolated examples is not acceptable. And I'm, you know, in my current position, not going to tolerate poor governance. But we shouldn't let the actions of a few individuals tarnish the reputation of the whole sector. And that's, you know, what I want to be really vigilant about.
Let's try and keep this as clear and succinct as we can in terms of exchanges. If you actually look at other colleges, they've received packages of 21 months, 24 months. Do you find that unacceptable? Do you think somebody should receive a package of 20? And let's exclude North Glasgow and Coatbridge, whom have already been subject to Section 22 report. But let's look at other colleges. Some of them receive packages of over 20 months. Some of them receive payments in lieu of notice of over 6 months. I mean, some of them receive packages very similar in monetary terms, not that far off what Mr. Doyle and what Mr. Knox have been referred to. So do you find them unacceptable, those sums as well?
No, I don't find it acceptable, but I have to go.
Do you think they should pay it back?
I have to go on the concerns raised by the Auditor General. So there was two Section 22 reports that raised very, you know, significant concerns and serious feelings in governance. And
so it's okay if you tick the boxes then?
No, it's not okay if you tick the boxes.
Well, that's what the others have done.
No, well, I mean,
other colleges have said, yeah, we've ticked the box, here's the business case. I mean, what business case could possibly say that somebody should get above 13 months? Could you give me one example of that?
No, I can't
give
you an example.
So why did these other colleges, because it's an important part of our work, though, is to consider that Mr. Doyle can say, yeah, the others received they received 21 months, they received 24 months. So, you know, I've just bumped it up to 30, but, you know, we've been told it's 13, but the others are doing what they want anyway.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If you find it equally unacceptable for them, then why not say to them as well then? Because that wasn't what Mike Russell envisaged, was it? Did he want people to get payments of over 21 months when all the rest of the staff were given the basic terms?
Mm-hmm. I mean, what I'm saying to you, Mr. Martin, is that I don't think it is acceptable or fair, particularly given the challenges on the public sector, that there should be more preferential voluntary severance schemes for senior members of staff that are out of kilter with the rest of the sector, or indeed the rest of a region or the rest of an individual organisation. In terms of the strategic funds, those use of the strategic funds, there was very clear guidance and expectations around that. But the reality is that prior to ONS reclassification, colleges did have discretion in these matters. I'm glad to say that is not the case now. Even although they had discretion, it was for the colleges to be making very clear business cases, and we know that in some cases that did not happen, and that's not acceptable.
Okay. Scott.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask the Cabinet Secretary if ministers approved the budget for severance payments that the Funding Council then allowed to be spent on these deals right across Scotland.
Did ministers approve the budget? Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. And you'll be aware, Cabinet Secretary, that there are 14 such deals that have been brought to our attention by the Scottish Funding Council, which after all is your body, and the total claim from the Funding Council so far, and we haven't got the full figures yet, and it's not clear to me why we haven't been given the full figures yet, is £1.081 million. That's the contribution your budget made to those severance deals. Were ministers briefed on that as that process went on from 2011-12 onwards?
I mean, ministers would be in regular contact with the Funding Council and would indeed be discussing these matters. It is important to remember, and again, you know, the Auditor General for Scotland has confirmed that as a result of the merger process, and we acknowledge that voluntary severance has been part of that, that the merger process, you know, overall has been well planned and implemented, and that voluntary severance schemes overall have been appropriately implemented. and that savings have been made, and that in terms of the cost of voluntary severance, we're now in year three, and that it would take 3 years for the cost of severance to be paid back, if you like.
There are 14 severance payments that we've been given advice on, of which four are over 20 months. And Mr. Doyle's is not the cheapest. There's one that comes in at a whacking £314,946, of which the Funding Council contributed £133,788. Were ministers told about that one? Did the Funding Council tell ministers about these things?
The Funding Council would be in regular contact as they are with myself, and they would be in regular contact with my predecessor, and they would certainly be discussing the progress made through the merger programme, and they would indeed be discussing any concerns that were emerging at the time.
So it just feels like it was a price worth paying, that the merger process was obviously the government's objective, that had been approved by Parliament, and therefore the budget that you've very helpfully confirmed was agreed by ministers was just the price worth paying to get these merger deals done.
No, I think we're living with the reality of a set of arrangements, and that ministers don't have the power to direct college boards on these matters. That is something that my governance task group will certainly revisit. That power to direct colleges was given away, if you like, in 2006. And, you know, going forward, we want to ensure that we have the very highest of standards, but we have to remember that the merger programme overall is a success. It's a good example of public sector reform, where the college sector is delivering more for learners.
You'll forgive me if I stay on the issue that the Audit Committee are responsible for. These are wider points, not for our committee, but for other committees,
sure, okay.
So you'll, I'm sure, appreciate. Could ministers could have decided not to have a budget line for severance payments for the Funding Council? You simply could have decided that, as you very correctly say, these are matters for the boards themselves, and there was no need, was there, to have a budget line for severance payments from the Scottish Funding Council?
Well, in terms of the merger programme, there was a recognition that voluntary severance would be part of that,
yes.
And with any major programme of reform of that nature, that would be expected. And it was important, I believe, that the Scottish Government and the Funding Council to allocate funds to assist that merger programme for the overall good of the sector. So in essence, it was about investing money to save.
I mean, I totally agree. I could quite understand investing for the merger process. What I can't understand is investing to provide 14 enormous payoffs to former college principals and other key staff. That's a bit I don't think the committee can understand.
No. And what I'm saying, Mr. Scott, is there are cases where there have been unacceptably high severance payments. None of us like that, I can assure you. I certainly don't approve or appreciate the fact that there has been poor stewardship of public funds. But the Funding Council acted within the powers available to it at the time. The matter has been rightly scrutinised. I had tried to indicate to Mr. Martin that there is a case to look for where the Funding Council, I mean, and indeed ministers, where we can be more proactive to ensure that there can't and mustn't be a repetition of this poor governance, poor leadership and absolute poor stewardship of public funds. And that's what I'm absolutely determined to do, building on the success of the changes that have already taken place as a result of reclassification.
I'm sure we'd all agree with that, but we're concentrating again on what happened from 2011-12 onwards. I just want to be very clear that ministers were informed by the Funding Councils that these 14 separate severance payments
were taking place and that ministers were, it was brought to ministers' attention as to the scale of the contribution from the minister's own budget that was therefore incurred.
The information that would be available to me, Mr. Scott, would suggest that ministers would have been advised of concerns, but not at the time that decisions were being made or at the time where problems were arising. And I think Coatbridge is an example of that, where the decision was made in February and it didn't come to light to the October, either in terms of the Funding Council's awareness or indeed ministers' awareness. And I think that's where we need to look at, you know, what proactive processes could reasonably be put in place to ensure that that doesn't happen, bearing in mind that we now, the Funding Council now in effect has a veto over severance arrangements.
Yeah, I understand that. Can I ask one last question? Are you satisfied that in those 14 cases that there was a business case that will stand the test of the audit that Audit Scotland would do? Apart from the ones that you've already rightly mentioned, which Audit Scotland have already looked into, in the other cases, are you satisfied that the business case exists and it's a matter of, as it were, public record, that we could see that and be satisfied that that was the case?
Mm-hmm. No, I wouldn't be.
Thank you.
So just clarify, you wouldn't be able to clarify there's been business cases for all of the...
Well, I'm very conscious that the Auditor General has provided two Section 22 reports and has highlighted four other colleges where she didn't produce Section 22 reports, but she did highlight that you know, practice had fell short of what was expected, whether that was in and around processes.
Can we just clarify, though, for the other colleges who were part of the merger process, that we've asked the Funding Council for the business cases to be sent to us, which we've not received yet. Would you expect all of them to have had a business case?
I would expect a business case to have been followed and presented. I mean, that would clearly be the expectations.
And for the Funding Council, who have made the money available, to have had a copy of the business case?
I would indeed.
You would expect them to do that?
I would expect
it. Colm Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. Cabinet Secretary, we heard from Mr Doyle and Mr Gray an acceptance that the funds that were used were charitable funds, despite their attempt to obfuscate that the funding on the college's part came from commercial sources. Mm-hmm. Do you have a concern about the use of charitable funds for this sort of payment?
Well, of course, members of boards are charity trustees, and there's a role for OSCAR, and there is legislation in and around charities that board members have to comply with. Irrespective of the source of funds, whether funds come from the public purse or charitable or commercial activity, it has to be recognised that some of that commercial activity will come from the public sector. So I think the issue is the same if it's about the stewardship of funds, and where there has been poor stewardship of funds, it doesn't really matter whether they're from charitable or commercial purposes or activities, or whether they're for public funds. I mean, poor financial governance is poor financial governance at the end of the day.
Do you think there's a case for bringing in legislation to cope with situations where excessive payments have been made from the public purse and clawback is needed or appropriate?
I think it's always in these circumstances to consider what would be appropriate or helpful. I know that OSCAR are reviewing the evidence at committee very carefully and are following matters. I know that OSCAR currently have powers in and around disqualification. They present an annual report to Scottish ministers, which is laid in Parliament at the same time. And in previous years, that has focused on more technical aspects, but that is an opportunity, I suppose, for OSCAR to make recommendations about charities legislation, because we do want to ensure that it is robust and fit for the future. In terms of clawback, Obviously, a lot of that relates to employment law. And, you know, we don't have any, you know, facilities just now to make changes to employment law. There is legislation and proposals that are going through the UK Parliament just now in terms of two separate bits of legislation. One is the Enterprise Act, and the other is a Small Business Enterprise and Employment Act. And that process that the UK government has to go through in terms of its own parliamentary process won't be complete till March. Obviously, the Scottish government is following that very carefully, but there are some proposals in both of those bits of legislation in and around a cap on voluntary severance, and there is also a proposal in terms of clawback, where people have worked in the public sector have earned more than £100,000, and if they turn up in employment in the public sector 12 months later. So, you know, there will be scope for other matters to be considered.
Cabinet Secretary, you've obviously got a working group functioning at the moment, looking at various aspects. You've described that even under the present arrangements, it would be very difficult for this situation to repeat itself. Are you satisfied at this moment that the present structure would avoid this situation arising again?
I'm given some reassurance by the evidence and comments by the Auditor General for Scotland, who acknowledges that the new arrangements are far more robust. When you're dealing with the individual actions of a few individuals, you can't always legislate or have policy and procedures that will remove all risk of individuals at a future point in time behaving inappropriately or exercising poor judgments or poor governance. But what I'm absolutely determined to do, as far as humanly possible, is to make sure that we have no repetition of what we have seen in Coatbridge College, or indeed in the other colleges where there has been concern. And I won't tolerate poor governance, and want to assure committee that the task force is looking at all these matters very, very closely, and of course will be paying close attention to the forthcoming report from committee.
Just one last question here about the SFC. I think one of the frustrations this committee's had has been that the only mechanism for penalising appears to be to cut college funding, to claw back from the college, which of course nobody wants to do, because that impacts more on the students than it does on the people who have crossed the line. Is there some comfort coming down the line on that particular, that will the SFC have more teeth?
I think there's two things I'd want to highlight, convener, to Mr. Beattie's question. I think it is a very important point that the Funding Council currently can, you know, introduce, you know, financial sanctions, but to do that would only be at the expense of, you know, the college or institution itself, or students, or the day-to-day operations. And it is understandable that the Funding Council, you know, wouldn't want to do that, you know, implement, you know, something that could be quite draconian and that would have an impact on learners, you know, through no fault of their own, but as the result of individuals. But it does beg the question about what other sanctions the Funding Council should have at its disposal, because sanctions should be a deterrent, but they also need to be workable if required. And that's something that we'll, again, we'll look at very closely through the work of the task group. But to go back to my earlier point, obviously we want to be nipping any difficulties in the bud We want to be looking at what proactive preventative action can be taken to ensure that, you know, the funding council doesn't have to, you know, use its veto powers or indeed use sanctions.
Your phrase there actually is the one that is I want to address, and that's nipping in the bud. In 2011-12, Stevenson College and Telford College operated a scheme known as the Edinburgh Scheme with a 21 months redundancy. Now, we haven't got the details from the funding council as to how much they contributed towards that, but the sums were substantial, 249,000 in one case and 202,000, being the total cost of release in these two colleges. The evidence that we've been getting on Coatbridge College, which also refers to involvement in other college mergers, would indicate very strong government involvement, and Mr. Mullen, as the point person for Mr. Russell, appears to have been very engaged in this to the extent of writing papers for these merger boards, providing support of various sorts. The government surely would have been aware in 2011-12 that Stevenson College and Telford College had operated a voluntary severance scheme which was 21 months and not the 13 months that the funding council were recommending. What was the reaction of government to that?
I mean, I'm not aware that the government was aware prior to decisions being made, you know, either at Telford or Stevenson College. We can, of course, you know, go back and scrutinise the detail for Mr. Simpson and committee on that point.
It'd be helpful to know if Mr. Mullen was involved in those two early ones, because if he was, he would perhaps then have appreciated the difficulties that were arising in which he was involved in severance arrangements at Coatbridge, because what I don't understand is one of the defences I think that Mr. Doyle and Mr. Gray were putting up is, well, there was the Telford scheme and that had been operated, or the Edinburgh scheme or the South Lanarkshire scheme as it's been variously called. That scheme's been operated, so, you know, why should it apply to one set of principles and not to others? And that, you know, is leaving aside the governance arrangements, which we've agreed were very poor in reaching these decisions, but as a defence, that strikes me as not really totally unreasonable. And I just don't understand why, if that was something that was unacceptable, and you've said it was unacceptable to have these exceptional payments, why it was not picked up and run. So could we see, perhaps it would be useful to have a diary of Mr. Mullen's involvement in all the colleges' mergers, because that would give us an understanding of, in relation to the minutes of the merger committees, as to exactly what was going on in terms of information being passed to the government.
Well, I mean, there's two things there, convener, that I'd like to say to Dr. Simpson. I'm not sure that is a defence saying that because something happened elsewhere that it can, you know, automatically happen in your own institution. And, you know, the government and the funding council were clear about the restraint that should be shown over the use of the strategic funds to assist with voluntary severance. And, you know, we've rehearsed a lot about, you know, the powers that existed then and the powers, the tighter controls that now exist. It's important to stress that Roger Mullen had no role in decisions around voluntary severance. These were matters for board management.
Sorry to interrupt, but I'm not suggesting that. And if that's the impression I've given, I'm not saying he had that role. I'm asking. My concern was that he was at all these meetings, he would be aware of this. And if there were concerns, which you've expressed and the government, you've said it was unacceptable, these arrangements, but these arrangements were in place for Telford College and Stevenson College. Now, Mr. Mullen was not at all involved in that. I can understand that the government would not be aware of it. But if Mr. Mullen was involved in the Stevenson and Telford mergers and the discussions around the voluntary severance payments for Brian Lister and Miles Dibstall, then, you know, if it was a concern, even if it wasn't a concern, the government would then have been aware, or at least a government point person would have been aware of what was going on. So it's not that he was responsible in any way for them, but he would be aware of it. And I would like to really have clear that he wasn't aware of it by seeing diaries that demonstrate that he was not involved in the Stevenson or Telford mergers where severance payments was in any way discussed.
I think we have to be careful about making assumptions about...
I'm not making any assumptions.
What people...
I'm asking a question, not an assumption, Minister.
And, of course, Dr. Simpson, if there is more information that we can give about the role of Roger Mullen, but, I mean, his role was that he was employed, had a contract of employment due to his very specific experience and expertise in change management and organisational change. We know that an important part of a successful merger is about establishing the culture of new organisations, and the sort of work that he was involved in was completing culture studies at the request of institutions who wished them, and that was to assist with the merging of organisations to ensure that they had the best chance of success and that we're on a solid footing. So if we can send committee, if committee wishes, an example of the sort of work that Mr. Mullen was involved in, I'm happy to do so, and to establish what other information we have about activities and meetings, if that's helpful.
Yeah, it's actually, I want to make it absolutely clear, convener, I'm not being critical of Mr. Mullen or his CV or his experience. I would like to know when he started his job. He obviously finished at the end of the process, or certainly in May this year. But I'd like to know when he started and whether he was present at the Stevenson and Telford College involvement in their merger discussions when severance payments were discussed. I reiterate, he was not in any way... His job was about the culture, mm-hmm. and I've read the papers, some very... useful and interesting papers about developing the culture of merger for the Lanarkshire College and the Ayrshire Colleges. So there's not a problem there. It's actually about the about whether he was present when these issues were discussed and therefore would have had knowledge of it, which, if there were concerns being expressed about this, should have been passed on, because it was out with the Funding Council's guidance. Can I move to a final question? And that is, we've just been supplied with the Linkston report. When did you become aware of that? When did you receive that report or have knowledge of it?
I mean, I personally had aware of the Linkston report in advance of my meeting with the family of Francis McGeachy, who, had, requested to meet with me around what progress had been made to implement the Linkston report. In terms of when that report was provided to my predecessor, that would be, I'll check the date, but that would be 2014. The report was produced November 2014.
Thank you. That would be very useful to get...
You met with the family, or just roughly what winter?
Yes, I'll check my diary, but I'm sure it was the 4th of November.
This year. That's fine. If the government were aware of this report and were also aware that this this committee had begun an investigation of the Coatbridge situation, nobody thought to actually give us the Linkston report until, in fact, this week, convener?
Yeah.
And we've been at this now for some considerable period of time, and that report is a highly pertinent document. Your officials must have been following the evidence. Did nobody think to actually say at some point, hang on, they've clearly not got the Linkston report, because that has quite a bit of information in it about the situation. I'm not saying it was your responsibility, Minister.
No.
I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying, did nobody think to help this committee by pointing out to the Scottish Funding Council that they should try to ensure that this report was in front of us?
Yeah. And maybe I can clarify some aspects of that, convener. My understanding was that the Funding Council had been in touch with the committee in October. In terms of the background, Yes, I mean, the Funding Council commissioned a review of the management of the merger process in Lanarkshire and, you know, its impact on senior staff. And when that report was completed, and you'll appreciate that, you know, the backdrop is highly sensitive, you know, around the tragic death of Francis McGeachy. And my predecessor, like me, had met with the family or representatives of the family and had agreed that the report, certainly in the first instance, would have a limited circulation. The report went to the new principal and the new chair of the newly merged college. When the Auditor General requested access to the report, that was facilitated. External auditors had access to the report, and the family of Francis McGeachy had said to me at our meeting that they were comfortable with the report being made available to committee, that they, you know, had never intended it to be confidential. They'd been watching proceedings and investigations undertaken by the committee, and, you know, were content for that report to be released.
Well, in fact, as a convener, as you know, the family did provide us with that report. So,
just to confirm, we received
it in October, but right, on the 20th of this month, right, okay, from the Scottish Funding Council, okay, attached to a letter okay, advising us. So, just to clarify, I don't know where October comes into it. But
thank you.
Okay, Mary Scanlon.
Can I just ask, given that ministers appoint the chairs of college boards, creating a direct line of accountability to ministers, it does concern me, and I think the general public out there have taken a fair degree of interest in this Coatbridge situation, that really, if it wasn't for the Auditor General and Section 22 report, we would actually know nothing about John Doyle's 304,000. Were there concerns raised? I mean, obviously, we're going from some 30-odd colleges to 13. So one in three principals was going to have a job after it. I mean, and every party supported the mergers. But we supported it on the lines that it would be higher quality education, there would be efficiency savings, and it would reduce duplication. So we were looking forward, you know, to quality of education, but also efficiency savings. But surely in all of that, there must have been quite considerable discussions about severance payments. Do you have a minute of the college chairs and the accountable officer in the government where severance payments were discussed and advice was given to chairs of college boards?
I think it's important to point out, Mrs. Scanlon, that in terms of the individuals that the principal and the chair of Coatbridge College at the time of these appalling events, that the government had no role in appointing the then chair of Coatbridge College, that yes, arrangements have now changed because
the government not appoint John Gray.
No.
Was John Gray not appointed by ministers?
No, he wasn't. He wasn't. The situation that you refer to about the government now appointing regional chairs and chairs of college boards as a result of the legislation. So that's practice now, is one of the benefits of the 2013 Act, where there is a more regulated process around these very, very important appointments. These jobs are done by volunteers, but nonetheless, we expect the highest of standards. But the government didn't appoint
John Gray. As the holder of the office of as chairman of the College Board of Coatbridge, and given that his line of accountability was to ministers, were there regular meetings during the merger process to ensure it was a success? Were there regular meetings with officials and with government? And were severance payments discussed?
It's the role of the funding council to take on that monitoring process so that you described.
So it was the funding council that was overseeing the process towards merger, including the severance payments?
Yes.
Right. My second question, quite a bit has been mentioned about the Scottish Funding Council had an ability to claw back money, which they didn't do. Mm. So, in a sense, they failed in good governance. But could I just ask, and I'm asking the question in retrospect, but also for future, why was the Scottish Funding Council payout not on the condition that severance payments were in line with their recommendations and their guidelines? So if they'd said to Coatbridge, OK, you know, we will only pay out if you adhere to our guidelines. So was that in place? And is it in place in future with the new arrangements that you've got in place?
Yeah. There's three aspects to your question, Mrs. Scanlon. In terms of the payout, the payment was actually made on the 25th of October, and Funding Council funds were not released until March 2014. And one of the aspects of this affair that is completely unsatisfactory, as apart from the fact the decision, the actual decision on severance packages was made away back at the beginning of the year in 2013, and there was no visibility of that for the Funding Council to the October, was that despite you know, a concerted level of activity between the 10th and 24th of October, of the Funding Council communicating in writing and in person that, you know, this, you know, that the current package was not acceptable. The decision was made on, it was either the 23rd or the 24th of October, and the payment was actually made on the 25th of October. Normally, the normal practice, I'm told, is that payments are made, you know, a month in arrears when people are paid. So there was a very hasty decision made about the actual payment, about the money leaving you know, the college, public money leaving the college and going into an individual's bank account. So the decision, you know, that the Funding Council did fail, and of course it could have clawed back the money from the college, but that wouldn't have penalised the individual with £300,000 and their bank balance. It would have penalised the college. And, you know, a judgment had to be made about, you know, the impact on the college at that time. In terms of the new arrangements, well, as the Auditor General has said, you know, in effect, the Funding Council now has a veto over arrangements, because prior approval must be sought before decisions are made and money is paid. So there is a different set of arrangements that are now in place, and that veto, if you like, exists irrespective of whether it is commercial funds or indeed public funds that are being used for a severance package.
So I am aware of all that, but I just wondered, rather than clawback, could the Scottish Funding Council not have said to Coatbridge, we will not pay our £1.3 million unless you adhere to our guidelines? Could they have done that previously at the time of the Coatbridge?
Well, they made, the Funding Council made it very, very clear, again in correspondence, and, you know, I quote, you know, correspondence, you know, from the Funding Council on the 24th of October, saying you should not pay or take any further steps to commit to any deal along the lines you have indicated to me until you have reassured me, you know, that the voluntary severance arrangements are in accordance with good practice.
Yes, but they still didn't say, you know, we are not paying anything above our guidelines. Did they have the ability, the responsibility and the power to say that? Yeah. Could they have withheld any funding that was over and above their guidelines.
But the facts of the matter are that the Funding Council in March didn't pay over and above their guidelines. The college, from their own resources, paid the excess, if you like. So that's still unsatisfactory in terms of the actual payment being taken from college funds. But the Funding Council didn't pay in excess of their guidelines.
Right, my final question, and I think we're all very grateful to the family of Francis McGeehee for giving us sight of the Linkston report. But I have to say, I've been totally outraged at the money John Doyle walked away with, but the compassion and empathy for the staff at that college was, you know, it's just tantamount. It's quite, reading this report, it's not only tragic, it's horrendously sad. I just want to read one sentence to you. Poor governance and decision-making had a cumulative negative impact on senior staff. Certain decisions, practices and behaviours fell short of what I would expect in a well-governed college. Now, the colleges are absolutely, totally, publicly funded by the taxpayer. So what responsibility, we've heard John Doyle's lack of responsibility and duty of care to his staff, and I think all of us can put on the record, you know, our grateful thanks and how much we value every person that teaches and gives their time, whether it's NHS, but particularly in colleges. But what duty of care did the government have? Because you must have been very aware that many people were facing uncertainty about their future incomes, their future roles, their future careers. This is quite devastating on the staff, this Linkston report. Were the government, did that form part of any discussions? Was any pastoral care suggested? Or, you know, what was the government's role in this?
Mm-hmm. I think the report prepared by Alec Linkston does make for salutary reading.
Yeah.
Although he does say that the new College Lanarkshire merger process, you know, overall, you know, was very comprehensive.
But we're just talking about Coatbridge.
Very sound. Yeah. He nonetheless, you know, highlighted, you know, a number of significant weaknesses in governance and leadership. And, you know, the fact that there were so many differing accounts of, you know, a very significant matter, you know, I found very troubling. I know that the author of that report found very troubling, and, you know, I think demonstrates, you know, the extent of dysfunction and disharmony within the college. And, you know, there were very high levels of sickness within the senior management team, and, you know, if there are, and there are lessons to be learned, I mean, we need to find ways to be more vigilant to that level of sickness absence, particularly within a senior management team, because that, you know, should set, you know, alarm bells about how an organisation is performing or is coping. So, you know, there is a commitment by the Scottish Funding Council, and I will oversee that commitment. The Funding Council have accepted all the recommendations from the Linkston report. Some of those recommendations have already been implemented. Other recommendations will be, you know, implemented. For example, you know, the issuing of, you know, further guidance on severance. But the Funding Council have not issued that as yet, and they've explained that to the family because they want to receive the report from the Public Audit Committee to ensure that the findings of this committee also feed into any subsequent guidance that's issued.
Right, I'll just leave it there.
Just before we move on to the next question, I just clarify, just to take you back, Minister, you referred to when the payment was processed by the Funding Council. Mm-hmm. We've got an email that's been provided to the committee dated the 10th of December 2013 from John Kemp, and if I can read, who's the Funding Council representative, and it says here, this is to Derek Banks, who's the Director of Finance at Coatbridge College, and he says here in the first paragraph, I'm happy to confirm that we will pay 13 months' salary subject to a valid claim being made against our voluntary service funding for the merger. I anticipate that the Council will agree to transitional funding requested for the merger at this meeting on Friday the 13th.
But my understanding, Convener, is that the payment was not made until March. We'll, of course, double-check the accuracy of that.
But what we've got here is a senior official at the Funding Council making it clear, the payment's going to be made. He's not saying here, let's not make this payment. He goes on to say, given that in almost every other merger I've been involved in, and due diligence has been finalised prior to the amount of transitional funding being made available. Mm-hmm. I cannot see the fact that Friday's meeting has not taken place that yet has been an impediment in this. However, please let me know and I will arrange either Sharon or herself will phone you to advise you of the outcome of the meeting. Yeah. So it's a pretty clear email that's saying you're going to get the money. Mm-hmm. Nobody's saying you're not getting the money. It's a clear commitment.
What, on the basis of the 13 months salary, the 24 months?
Yeah, still processing it. Okay, Nigel Dunn.
Secretary, I note your comments that in the future this kind of thing won't be able to happen again. I'm just looking, though, to explore some of the detail of that, if I may, because if I look at the table we've helpfully got here about previous payments, there are voluntary severance lump sums, but there are also some pension contributions. Mm. Some quite eye-watering sums in the pension contributions. I'm just wondering whether you could give me some reassurance that pension contributions would also be covered by the change in governance arrangements.
I mean, it is important that we, look at everything in the round and indeed processes that lead to the overall cost to the public purse. One of the changes that was made to the severance package that the principal did receive at the end of the day was that they did show restraint on the pension aspect. Nonetheless, the overall package that the principal of Coatbridge received was nonetheless still eye-watering. And I'll just ask Aileen if you can maybe say something about pension contributions.
We will absolutely take into account the widest implications of funding contribution to voluntary severance as part of the task group consideration. So pension would absolutely come into that.
Right. I am grateful for that comment, because whilst in the cases in front of us, they obviously were paid by the college rather than by the SFC, it's all still public money and it mm-hmm. can't be paid twice and it can't be used twice. So I'm grateful for that reassurance. Thank you.
No. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned the working group, which is underway. In terms of the focus of that particular working group, is that just going to be based on the college sector, or is it going to include the university sector as well?
Actually, we'll look further afield. We had the first meeting of the task group last week. And, we agreed that we will look at a range of sectors out with education. There is a representative from Oscar on that group. And, there is some interesting developments around governance in the financial sector that appears quite apposite for us to look at. But we'll look at, good practice in health. And we'll also look out with Scotland as well. We're conscious that the task group, we want to come to a view about clear actions and to report back to Parliament on those clear actions. So we don't want the task group to be meeting for forever and a day. It's a short-term working group. If you like, but we are, looking further than the world of education and further in Scotland to inform best practice and how we build on the work that's currently done by the sector-led good governance group as well.
So in terms of the action points that will come out after the end of the work and the report, will those action points be aimed towards the college sector solely, or college and university?
This piece of work, this task group, is solely focused on the college sector, and for very good reasons, you know, falling on from recent decisions that I've taken around Clyde College, but also falling on from the two Section 22 reports prepared by the Auditor General and indeed the Public Audit Committee report on North Glasgow. So it's focused on the issues and difficulties, you know, highlighted by this committee and the Auditor General.
And you mentioned Oscar, and also we had Oscar provide evidence to this committee, and I did pose a question to them in terms of further powers or further areas that they would like to see in terms of tools in their armoury. Now, has there been any discussions between yourself or your department and Oscar in terms of the current powers that they have and potentially any additional powers that that they might obtain or potentially could obtain to actually help them undertake their roles and their responsibilities in a more effective manner going forward?
There's an ongoing dialogue between Scottish Government officials and Oscar, and also the Funding Council and Oscar, and as I said, there's a representative from Oscar that sits on the College Good Governance Task Group as well. So, it's part of our wider considerations, but of course it is for Oscar, you know, to bring forward proposals as well, and they have an opportunity to do that in terms of their annual report that they, you know, bring to Scottish ministers and also we in Parliament.
Has Oscar raised any particular areas up to now in terms of additional powers that they would like to see have, so that they could be considered by the government for any potential future legislation?
They've not made, to the best of my knowledge, any formal requests on the government to legislate in and around their powers as a regulator. But, you know, as always, we are vigilant and open to any consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just ask just a brief final question, Minister? A theme that we have heard during these, this is the last evidence session that we have on the subject, and it's the theme's been around management versus those other staff who have just received the basic terms, but management staff have received enhanced terms. And I take it, I mean, you like us in this position, I take it your predecessor was the same, where you would have liked to have seen parity across the board for all members of staff.
I'm very clear, convener. I don't think we should have one scheme for one set of staff and another scheme for the other. There needs to be parity.
So we're all agreed on that. So that, and that, would that have been the same for your predecessor, Michael Russell?
I mean, he was very clear with regards to the need for restraint and good business cases in terms of the strategic funds for the voluntary severance.
But with his position, which is Scottish Government's position, I take it, that everyone should just receive the same deal, regardless of whether you're a principal or you're a catering staff, whoever you are, you all play a role in the college and you all should just receive the same deal.
That's my view, and I hope I'm making that view clearly to committee.
Yeah, but I'm asking, was it Mike Russell's view?
It's a bit difficult for me to ask what my predecessor's personal view.
Well, could Ms. McKechnie advise us in the position?
I'm afraid I wouldn't know the detail of that, whether or not that was my expectation would have been that would have been our collective view.
Because what I think would be helpful would be to see an audit trail of that principle, because I think politically we would have had an argument to say, yeah, mergers are going to take place, and I would expect whoever's leading that politically, which would be the minister, to say, I'm expecting everyone to receive the same principled settlement. But what you can see from the various strands that took place was that the Scottish Funding Council were implicated in a process which was that somehow senior managers should receive a better deal from those other members of staff in the college, despite, as politicians, all of us saying that's a disgrace. Mm-hmm. So the point I'm making is, as being the minister who was responsible for that at the outset, Mike Russell, it would be helpful for the committee to be very clear what audit there is of the information that's provided to Scottish Funding Council, to make it clear to them what you're saying to us today, and which I suppose we're all agreed on, is that everyone should receive the same deal, regardless of who you are.
It is important to recognise the, you know, the limitations on ministerial powers, but I think I want to be clear that moving forward and looking to the future, that it is important that I and the Scottish Government are very clear on standards and on leadership and on what's expected, and we're obviously, you know, acknowledging that there are new, tighter, sharper controls now in place post-reclassification, but we are vigilant to what more can and should be done to ensure the very highest of standards across the college sector.
Thank you, Mr. Cabinet Secretary, thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you.
Can I just a very brief interval to allow for changeover? Very brief on that. Okay, I now move to agenda item number 3, which is oral evidence on the AGS report entitled the 2014-15 Audit of the Scottish Government's Consolidated Accounts. I'd like to welcome Callan Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Mark Taylor, the Assistant Director, and Gordon Smale, who's the Senior Manager of Audit Scotland. I understand that Callan Gardner has a brief opening statement to make.
Thank you, Convener. As the committee knows, the Scottish Parliament is currently developing its approach to scrutiny, reflecting the increasing financial powers, and the Public Audit Committee taking evidence on the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts is an important part of this. This is the right time to strengthen parliamentary scrutiny of the consolidated accounts, and I've provided this report to support your process. The consolidated accounts are a critical component of the Scottish Government's accountability to Parliament and the public. They cover over 90% of the spending approved by Parliament each year and show the amounts government spent against each main budget heading. They also show the assets, liabilities and other financial commitments carried forward to future years and contain an annual report in which the government gives a high-level account of its activities and performance. My independent opinion on the consolidated accounts is unqualified. This means I'm content that they provide a true and fair view of the government's finances. Beyond that, Convener, I'd like briefly to highlight four areas from my report. First of all, on financial management and reporting, the majority of the budget approved by the Scottish Parliament relates to spending programmes and administration costs covered by the Scottish Government consolidated accounts. The Government managed its budget for 2014-15 within the overall limit set by the Parliament. The accounts meet the legal and accounting requirements. They show the financial position and budgetary performance from the perspective of the government's role in managing the budget it controls directly. However, it's becoming increasingly important to also understand the overall position of the devolved Scottish public sector as a whole. I've previously highlighted that there is no single set of accounts that shows this. That means it's difficult for the Scottish Parliament and for taxpayers to get a full picture and understanding of the longer-term implications of public finances. It remains firmly my view that the case for enhanced reporting of Scotland's public finances has never been stronger. Accounts for the whole of the devolved public sector would complement the Scottish Government's own accounts. Secondly, on corporate governance, a governance statement prepared by the Permanent Secretary is a key feature of the consolidated accounts. That statement summarises how the core organisation is controlled and directed. In my view, the overarching governance arrangements in place during 2014-15 were generally affected and provided an appropriate framework for organisational decision-making. Thirdly, performance. As I indicated, the consolidated accounts contain an annual report which summarises financial performance for the year, with particular emphasis on performance against budget. It also signposts where more performance information is available and refers to the Scottish Government's National Performance Framework. The Government has been building on its arrangements to better report how it's directing resources towards its desired outcomes and the impact that this is having. In my view, a more rounded account of the Scottish Government's overall performance as part of an expanded annual report would enhance this reporting and help to strengthen accountability and scrutiny. Fourthly, Convener, the other significant issues that I highlight in my report are threefold. The continuing risk to the Common Agricultural Policy Futures Programme, the suspension of European Structural Funds programmes, which provides financial support for improvement, and the Office for National Statistics classification of non-profit distributing projects and the potential implications for capital budgets. Overall, the Scottish Government has a good record of financial management and reporting, governance arrangements are generally effective, and the National Performance Framework is well established. Together, these form a strong base to meet the challenges of tighter budgets and increasing financial power. My audit work has identified a number of areas for improvement from that base, and we will continue to support the independent scrutiny of Scotland's public finances through all of our work and through this committee. As always, Convener, my colleagues and I are happy to answer the committee's questions.
Yeah, thank you, Auditor General, for an opening statement. Can I move straight to questions and move to Mary Scanlon?
I was quite surprised in paragraphs 34 and 35 that Scotland still doesn't have a balance sheet. We don't know our income, we don't know our expenditure, we don't know our pension liabilities in the public sector, and I think I've raised this before with you, but I certainly have a serious concern about local government debt. And somewhere that has to be recognised. If you'll forgive me, Convener, we've been through a referendum campaign and deliberations about Scotland's balance sheet were very pertinent to that campaign. We're going to be facing a referendum campaign sometime in the future. After 9 years of a government that's looking for Scotland to stand on its own and to have its own balance sheet and to be financially and otherwise independent, after 9 years, why don't we know what Scotland's income and expenditure is?
I think one of the main messages of my report, Ms Scanlon, is absolutely the need for that overall picture of Scotland's public finances. I think having a picture of what both the liabilities and the assets are helps this Parliament to make better decisions for the longer term and will help taxpayers and citizens across Scotland to understand the risks and the opportunities we face. And I think the new financial powers that are coming to the Parliament under both the Scotland Act 2012 and the newer Scotland Bill mean the importance of that information is heightened. I understand that the Government have accepted in principle the need to develop a more comprehensive picture, and what I call for in this report is now a more detailed plan and time scale to take that forward as a matter of urgency.
With all due respect, Auditor General, you have called for this before.
I've been reporting on this since July 2013, I think, which is why I'm now looking for a detailed
plan. So when
plan.
Would you expect to get this information from the government? And I think you're right, it's not just politicians that want to see it. I think Scottish taxpayers have a right to see that information. When would you expect it, and why is there the delay?
I think the question about why there's a delay is one you might want to pose to the Permanent Secretary when you take evidence in December. Yeah. My view is, though, is that it becomes increasingly urgent with the new financial powers that are coming to the Parliament as we speak.
Absolutely. My final, I'll just put the two questions together. The European funding, Common Agricultural Policy, we're about to discuss ICT, but it's now three times over the budget. 62 million, and the forecast is 178. And I quote paragraph 50, there remain significant risks to successful delivery, not just now, but the risks will remain until full implementation and beyond. And just my final question, because we have talked about this before and an update would be helpful, but I was very concerned about paragraph 55, the robustness of information being retained by some grant recipients about how ESF funds were being spent. Is there likely to be a clawback of funds? Are you implying that, your language is always very polite, so are you implying that funds have not been spent on what they were drawn down for? I just wonder if you could give this committee a little bit more clarity on that issue.
Certainly, Ms. Gannon. You've asked about both the CAP Futures programme and structural funds. I'll ask Mark to pick up the CAP Futures piece first and then come back on the
second.
Thank you. Thank you, Auditor General. Yeah, on CAP Futures, as you've said, Mrs. Scanlon, we've brought information to this committee before, and our intention is to bring a report in the new year about how the progress of the system is going. We've identified previously, and we continue to have concerns, that the project is facing significant risks. The government recently set out its timeline for payments, and we'd hope that arrangements are in place to make those payments.
By instalments?
We'll stay close to that, and we'll report to the committee and more generally in the new year.
How significant are the significant risks?
I think there's two issues that the committee will be aware of, but just to confirm, there's issues around delivery and value for money of the project itself in terms of how quickly systems can be put into place and how effective those systems are and the costs and the management of the project associated with that. And the committee's had an ongoing interest in that area. I think the other risk, and just to clarify, is it's important to get those systems into place so that the Scottish Government can demonstrate to Europe, to the European Commission, that it's following the rules that it needs to follow. And a real test of those systems, as well as making payments to farmers, of course, are the way in which the government's able to demonstrate that it's followed those rules, has the appropriate control systems in place. And as part of our wider programme of work, we have a responsibility, once payments have been made, to look at those controls and to report on those controls to the European Commission.
I know other members want to come in, so I'll leave that one just now, and if I could just get a response on the ESF funds.
Thank you. On the structural funds, it's right that we highlight this area. There's a substantial amount of money flows through from the European Commission on this side of things as well, something in the order of £81 million in the 14-15 accounts that we're looking at today. The situation is that there have been interruptions in the past, and that's quite a common occurrence across the schemes across Europe. And what we're reporting here is an escalation to this category called suspension. In direct answer to your question, really there is an uncertainty about what the implications of this situation is. In the interruption situation, the managing authority, but the Scottish Government, can actually make a self-correction of a relatively small amount that can be recycled through the process. In the case of suspension, the managing authority, Scottish Government, has to do a lot more. There's a lot more tests for them. They have to, for example, produce an action plan of how they're going to resolve matters. And the reason I explain all that is just to underline the uncertainty, because at the moment, that action plan is now with the EC. They will consider that, and then we'll decide what to do after that. And it's got a range of options available to it, including the self-correction type of situation that I mentioned, but also they are got an opportunity to apply penalties to the Scottish Government. But I very much emphasise that will take some time to come through, and then even if our penalties are suggested, there'll be some negotiations between Government and the EC about what these penalties might be. But it's a serious situation, and it's something we want to highlight here.
So are there any particular projects that you can tell this committee today where funds have been accessed through the ESF, European Structural Fund, and they have been misused? Are there any situations that you'd like to share with us today?
So if I go down a level into a bit more detail, what happens is that audit work is done on the individual projects. And what they look at are things like the quality of evidence that supports the expenditure, the procurement rules that have been applied. And what they do is, on basis on a sample, come forward with what they call an error rate. And it's those error rates that then determine the action that's taken.
Has the error rate increased in recent years?
It has, and that's one of the reasons why we go from this escalation from interruption to suspension.
And that would be the mismatch between what the funding was for and what it was used for.
Well, that's right, exactly. And then there is a discussion about what these error rates actually mean, and it's that that then applies to the amount of money that has to be either self-corrected or perhaps through penalties. Yeah. But very much the error rate, so it's against the sample. I'm not avoiding your question about individual cases because I couldn't name any today, but I just wanted to give you a sense of how the process works and how we get to this situation with our concerns about the funding.
Thank you. Well, in general, the report, as you might expect, is a fairly good one for the government with a few questions coming out of it. The cap futures, the figures you've given here, they haven't changed since your last report, have they? It's still the same figures. Yeah. Okay. I think if I remember correctly, you were going to be coming back to us at some point on this. When is your next follow-up due?
I'll ask Mark to give you the detail on that, if I may.
Yep. So there's two critical dates. The first date is the one that Mrs. Scanlon alluded to, which was the initial payments to farmers and the government's intention to get as many payments out the door in December and from December. And then there's a hard deadline at the end of June 2016 when all payments have to be made under European rules. Our intention is to come and report back to this committee and more generally between those two dates, a period where we've got real evidence around what progress has been and we're able to comment on the government's overall progress, but in advance of the 2016 date. One of the things that we'll need to manage is the timing of the election, when we can report around that, but we set out in this report that in a general sense we want to report in the spring of 2016.
Okay. Just turning to the report here, I'm looking at paragraph 29 on page 9. I was quite surprised to see such a large figure for NHS clinical and medical negligence claims, $302 million. Now, does that actually directly link to a potential liability, or is it just a pot they've got in case?
It relates to the scheme which is used to manage medical and clinical negligence across the NHS as a whole, and it's always one of the largest provisions within the accounts. As always, I will ask Mark or Gordon to pick up the detail of that to keep you straight on it.
Mark? I'll pick that one up. Yep, so the way in which the provision's an estimate of the amount that's liable to be paid out for cases, for medical cases and clinical and medical negligence cases that have already been brought against NHS bodies. And there's a well-established process that's managed through the Central Legal Office in the NHS to risk assess each of those cases and put a probability essential in each of those individual cases and assess the amounts that may be payable under each of those cases. And that allows the government overall to prepare an overall estimate, and I'll stress it is an estimate, but this is their best estimate of how much they expect to have to pay out over time in relation to the cases that have been raised.
So this figure isn't an annual figure, it's an accumulation of potential liabilities that are in this pot.
Yeah, so it's a balance sheet figure, for it's exactly that. It's the current balance, and it's built up over a number of years and will be met over a number of years.
Approximately how many cases are there? Just ballpark.
So afraid I don't have that information. Yeah.
It's just out of interest. Yeah. I mean, $300 million to me is an awful lot of money. And
as Mark has said, it is an accumulated figure of all of the cases across NHS boards across Scotland. It's audited at two levels, both at the level of the Scottish Government's balance sheet and at the individual boards, but we don't have the figure of how many claims is in there to hand at the moment.
Just turning to paragraph 35 on page 10 about pension liabilities. In recent years, pension liabilities have become a real problem because of changes in accounting and so on, and what the actuaries are now, how the actuaries are actually treating some of the funding. Is there no feel at all for what the figure is nationally? I mean, I know that in a small way, I'm involved with some local trusts, and they are crippled by the cost of pension funds.
You're absolutely right about the scale of the liability, and of course there has been action taken by both the Scottish and the UK governments to try and manage that liability over the longer term. I'll ask Gordon to give you a bit more about the figures that are available and what's not here in Scotland.
It's right that we'd settle on this, and in fact it's a very good example of why we think across the whole of the public sector we need that type of information available in a transparent way so that informed decisions can be made. Most recently, when we've actually had access to audited and good quality information, we've included a figure in the report back in July 2013 on developing financial reporting, where we were able to do that calculation, as I say, based on audited information. And at that time, the accumulated amount of liability was $66 billion, so it's a substantial number.
Is that just for Scotland?
Yes.
Gulp. Thank goodness it's not likely to become liable any time soon. Looking at the consolidated accounts, the value of the assets has been increasing over the years as a result of capital investment, but you say the liabilities have stayed broadly consistent. Why is that? I would have thought the liabilities would have edged up, you know, proportionally with the assets.
With that one, I think the asset increase is largely to do with capital budgets being applied and expenditure through the NPD programme and similar programmes. And what that does is it increases the amount of public funds that are invested in assets that will have a continuing benefit, and that's what the asset level, that's what the asset balance measures. The liabilities are largely, but not exclusively, independent of that, and that's the sort of things that we highlight in the report in terms of the general business of government and the organisations that are part of the consolidated account, how those liabilities are established. I think an important part as well of the overall picture is to understand some of the individual trends within those liabilities. You've highlighted clinical and medical negligence as one of those areas. We've also highlighted issues around provisions, for example, and there's an understanding of what's happening both at the headline level and within the individual balances. And again, we think through good reporting around the balance sheet, there's an opportunity to have a greater understanding of that.
Thank you. Can I ask a couple of questions? The first is, again, on power 29, early departure costs are £155 million. Presumably that's not just John Boyle, there's a few others in there. And secondly, I wonder if the Auditor General could just clarify in 38 your point about the government need to come up with a clear plan and timescale on a single set of Scottish accounts. Is it for the government to produce that single set of accounts, or do you have a view as to whether it should be the Fiscal Commission, or should it be, as it were, ultimately independently produced to allow the very open transparency and scrutiny that you were describing in your earlier remarks?
I absolutely think it should be the Scottish government that does it. I think there's a useful parallel in that the UK government for a number of years now has produced UK whole of government accounts which carry out that consolidation, and indeed includes the Scottish elements in there. What we don't have is that picture at a Scottish level, and I think it's increasingly important that we should have that.
And the £155 million early departure?
£155 million is the, it doesn't just relate to Mr. Doyle, and it's the figure across the accounts which are consolidated into the Scottish Government's
it's
consolidated accounts at the moment. It is a large number.
Has it gone up?
I don't know. I'll see if Mark can add to that. I would put it in context, though, and say we have been at a time of reducing scale of public services, and there is a cost associated with that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you.
Nigel Don.
Thank you, Convener, and hello again, Auditor General. I'd just like to pick up on the balance sheet and the information which Spice have given us of the background, helpfully produced. It looks as though the assets, two-thirds of those are the road network, and a substantial other part of that is buildings. Now, given that one of the ongoing problems which the NHS has is actually valuing its own buildings so that it can balance its books, that's something we'll explore again soon. Are you comfortable that those valuations are meaningful? I've no doubt they're professionally done. I'm not doubting any of that. But what assurance can we really have that even the buildings aspect of that is really realisable if we have to?
I will ask Mark, my expert on these matters, to respond to the question.
To confirm, of course, that they are, that we have confirmed that they're professionally prepared and appropriately referred. In terms of the question of meaningfulness, what those estimates do is they essentially estimate how much would it cost us to replace these buildings and how much would it cost us to replace these road networks and bridges. And that's the fundamental basis on which most of the assets, not all of the assets, but most of the operational assets in the accounts are valued. So it gives a sense of if they disappeared tomorrow, what would the cost of putting them back into the current state of repair be? And I think that is meaningful to give a sense, yes, of the investment that's been made previously in those assets and the value to the public sector.
Right, so they're not really assets in any realisable sense, nor does it value what you might be able to get as income if you were to part with them to somebody else. It's actually a shadow liability for what it would cost you to replace it.
So I don't know if I would recognise the phrase shadow liability, but it would be the cost
of
replacement.
Yeah, I mean, no accountant would, but I think you've got a point.
But essentially, and we make clear in the report, only those assets that are declared a surplus, they get valued on a different basis, which is essentially how much does, those assets are being actively marketed, and that's an estimate of what those will realise. And you'll see from the report, we think there's 42 million from memory that's the assets. So the vast bulk of assets have been built, have been established, and will continue to be used for public services.
Can I just add to that very briefly as well, Mr. Dunn? It's worth noting, as we say in the report, that the because there is no single picture of the overall assets and liabilities for Scotland's public sector, the figure for assets isn't complete. And probably the most obvious example of why that doesn't quite make sense is the roads network,
yes,
where the national roads network is on the consolidated accounts balance sheet. A large chunk of the roads network is the responsibility of local authorities and is on 32 different balance sheets valued on a different basis. So there's a real need to pull that together and get it done.
Thank you for preempting my next question.
Thank you, Peter.
Richard Simpson.
Yes, I suppose the same thing applies to PFI in respect of schools and hospitals. One is on the national balance sheet and one is on the local balance sheet.
Local authority assets and liabilities are, for good reasons, on the local authority's own financial statements. Yeah. NHS assets and liabilities are within the consolidated accounts here,
yes.
But we don't have that overall picture of them.
Yeah. Yes. It makes the same point. The sum on financial liabilities, one of the largest things is, of course, PFI. That'll be a figure that, in one respect, in terms of the early PFI contracts and even some of the PPP contracts will be reducing, but of course will be being added to by new NPD contracts that are coming along. In terms of, I mean, do we get a sense of that increasing, decreasing?
The reports that I've published on developing financial reporting have included a graph that shows by year the pattern of committed liabilities which is in place. And as you'd expect, it moves up towards a peak in around the early 2020s and then starts to trail off.
Yeah.
But it is added to as new commitments are made.
Okay. I want to ask about financial assets. The largest financial asset is the student loan sum. 2.685 billion pounds. What are the risks associated with that? Have you done some calculations as to what the collection of these loans and how much of it's actually likely to be collected and how much is not?
That's a particularly complicated area, and I'm going to ask Mark to do his best to talk you through it.
Thank you, Auditor General.
Sorry, Mark.
Yeah, of course. So just briefly, the way in which that liability is estimated is on collectible debt. So that is the government's estimate, and we're happy with that estimate that amount is currently collectible. And there's provisions against non-payment of debt in that estimate of that amount.
So the 2.685 billion is actually excluding a certain amount. So do we have a figure for that?
I don't have the figure for it, but it's just to give a bit more depth to that. There is modelling done which looks at a whole range of things, including the profile of people that still have amounts outstanding, their income, their likely income, and that type of thing. So
yes,
we do a lot of work around about that model to satisfy ourselves that the figures that are brought forward by government, included in the accounts, are materially correct. So there's a process for doing that.
So do we have a figure annually for the amount that's being written off for whatever reason?
Yes, it's in the accounts. There's a movement shown in the accounts for that.
Right. One other question, convener, and that is about on and off budget again. The ONS, of course, have with the ESA 10 issue, are looking at the possibility of assets coming on balance or off balance, and that's holding up a number of projects at the present time. Does that have any effect upon the consolidated accounts?
That's actually, for, again, complex reasons, an issue that affects budgeting much more than it does financial reporting. I'll ask Mark to talk you through it.
So the question of whether assets are on balance sheet or off balance sheet is one for the accounts, and generally the answer to that question currently is that they are on balance sheet and those assets are recognised in the accounts. As the Auditor General says, the ONS issue relates to the way in which budgetary control is currently applied and how much and spending controls. So the accounts themselves, in effect, already adopt an approach that ONS is moving toward.
So has the effect of the problems with police in terms of centralisation and VAT and the rest, and the colleges now being announced as being on balance, not off, do they have any effects? Or, I mean, they're separate issues, but...
So there's a whole bunch of questions in there, which essentially is that those bodies currently fall out with the consolidation boundary for these accounts. So the extent to which the accounting for those issues applies to those bodies lies out with this consolidation framework. Again, to come back to one of our central points, is a wider set of accounts would wrap those up in one place.
I think that makes your point even more. That's 3-4 times it's been made. I think it needs to be addressed urgently.
Thank you. I found the report to be very useful once again. Certainly, there's something in it for all of us around the table. You have been complimentary in terms of what the government does. Paragraph 60 regarding this, the national accounts classification, and the Scottish Government has applied the correct accounting treatment in preparing the accounts. But obviously, clearly, there is the issue of the ESA 10, and in paragraph 64. Where you highlight it's currently the Scottish Government is currently in discussion with the HM Treasury on the contingency arrangements. Are you aware of how these are progressing?
I think that's the question that you would best explore with the Permanent Secretary when you meet next month.
Yeah, okay. And just finally, certainly it's paragraph 67 in the conclusion where you highlight that notwithstanding the issue of the balance sheet that's been raised here today, you highlight the very beginning of the paragraph that the Scottish Government has a good record of financial management and reporting. Governance arrangements are generally effective and the National Performance Framework is well established. Certainly, would you be content that, obviously with any additional powers that are to come to this Parliament via the current Scotland Bill, with the arrangements that are there at the moment, that there is a good framework to build upon, but obviously some additional reporting mechanisms would be required as a consequence of these further powers.
I think I should start by being clear that I'm focusing on financial reporting here, and there's a much wider framework to be agreed around the new financial powers. But yes, my conclusion is that what we have in place currently on financial reporting and performance reporting provides a good basis, and I've identified a number of areas where I think improvement is now urgently required to underpin those new powers and the decisions the Parliament will have to make about them.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, can I thank the Auditor General and the team for their evidence, and we'll be considering the evidence received today in agenda item number 5 in private. And then move to agenda item number 4, which is a response from the Scottish Government on the AGS report entitled Managing ICT Contracts in Central Government, an update. Do members have any comments? Mary Scanlon?
Yes, I do have a comment. Convener, can I just remind you that prior to our current Auditor General, her predecessor, Bob Black, raised IT as one of his most serious legacy issues. That was over 4 years ago. And to be honest, I'm not impressed with the response that we've had from officials, and I think we just keep thinking, well, something's going to be done, and it never is. And today we've been looking at the common agricultural payments, already 3 times over the cost and significant risks. Last week we were looking at NHS 24, the IT system which appears to have collapsed. So without outlining any more problems, I would like to suggest that instead of always listening to officials, I spoke to an IT company last week and they told me that on the government's procurement list, there's 15 companies, one of which is a Scottish company, and that the Scottish IT sector gets 4% of the public sector spend. So I would like to suggest, convener, that we ask in representatives from, say, SME in Scotland and a larger company to try to get a better understanding of why this continues to be a problem, because in my time on this committee, we've never actually taken evidence from a company. We've only heard what officials and cabinet secretaries have to say. So I would like to suggest that, convener, on the same day as the permanent secretary's attendance on the 9th of December. And I think that's the only way that I would have some sort of insight, and it would enable me to help hopefully understand what is happening in IT in Scotland, because it's huge amounts of public money going on IT systems rather than the front line of public service.
Colin Beattie.
I understand where Mary's coming from, but I'm not sure what we'd ask these companies, because they don't know anything about the Scottish Government systems.
I'd ask them why we spend so much, why it always goes wrong, why it costs so much.
I think that's a very difficult one.
Just one at a time, please.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a very difficult one to get somebody in for and to get meaningful evidence from them. But what I am concerned about is what's been previously stated, which is the multiplicity, the bureaucracy, the different layers that have been put in place in a knee-jerk reaction to try and manage this.
Yes.
And that cannot be efficient. Mm-hmm. And I think we do need to pursue that piece of it. The bigger picture about IT, I think, raised with the Permanent Secretary, but I think we should be specifically targeting what we now know as a problem.
Tavish Scott and then Richard Simpson.
Thank you, Convener. I rather think that Colin Beattie just asked exactly the questions that it would be really good to put to some businesses, because they will be very well placed to answer questions about the government's procurement mechanisms and whether they're good, bad or indifferent. The company I'd like to have in is the one that spent £178 million not delivering farm payments. Now, it may be the considered view of the convener that that's not for now, because that process is still underway, but if ever there's a company that deserves scrutiny, both, I suspect, from the government's point of view, but also from an Audit Scotland clearly doing that, and more to the point from this committee's point of view, it's that particular example, because it's so far over budget.
Richard Simpson?
I would add to that the NHS IT, because that's massively over budget, been delayed 3 years. I agree with Colin's point about the structure. I did raise it at First Minister's questions and asked the First Minister to look at it, because it is just grossly overcomplicated. I have two other issues. One is there is a requirement in some of the procurements, quite rightly, that SMEs are given some of the subcontracting work. But at least in one example, a significant SME was promptly taken over by the central company, and therefore the SMEs SMEs delivery was actually then effectively nullified. The other thing that I've discovered, are we in public session?
Yes, we are.
We are live.
Yes, I know. I don't want to get into that. At least I'm not being.
The main colleagues. We are in public
right.
session. And I'm looking.
Well,
for
I will anonymise the contract. At least in one other very, very major contract, the contract, the two bidders for the contract, one won the contract, and then promptly subcontracted to the loser.
Okay.
Now I find that extraordinary. If the main contractor was unable to deliver without going to the subcontractor, who's making money out of that? There's something very wrong with our procurement system.
Can I just remind us, just before I bring Sean Mullen in, that this is about where we actually go after receiving this response.
Yeah.
I take it that colleagues are concerned that the response doesn't meet expectations.
Absolutely.
There is the option, if we are looking to attract businesses, to come in and speak to us about it of a round table approach, which all other committees have done.
Good.
And it could be that, not this side this year, but maybe next year.
Yeah.
Before the committee finishes Excellent. For the Scottish Parliament elections, that we have a particular session to look at that, and with a round table discussion, and that deals with management of what's quite a difficult issue to deal with. So
yes.
I think the proposal is that the Permanent Secretary would be coming at the next session, I would suggest, mm-hmm. along with the Chief Information Officer, and allow the government then to respond to the ICT mm-hmm. A document that's been laid before us by the Auditor General and then at a later stage there would be the committee in a position to do a round table discussion. I've got Stuart McMillan and then I'll bring in Nigel Don.
Well, thank you. Just is that a brief point? The concerns that have been raised by colleagues, a huge amount of sympathy for. But I think we also have to recognise that when it comes to ICT contracts and the delivery of them, unfortunately, ICT does move at such a pace. That, and it's something I've said on the record in this committee before as well, that certainly when you actually ship a box out of a factory, it's already out of date. And one of the things, so one of the areas of concern that I have raised in the past as well, and also do it again today, is just that in terms of the changes of specifications, that some specs might actually change whilst the project's underway. I mean, we're sitting in a building, but that did happen. So it's, I think that's a point that really does have to be considered when we are actually looking at this further.
Because you remind colleagues, we're actually just talking about how we manage this, so we can actually get into those details actually if we do a roundtable discussion. So Nigel Don.
Thank you. I guess I'm entirely with colleagues who want to talk to the people who are actually delivering, but I'm also very conscious that there will be commercial limitations on what they feel they can say, and it's extremely difficult in the real world for contractors to talk about their position with potential suppliers of further contracts. I'm just wondering whether there are academics, for want of a word, who have got some understanding of this. Maybe we're talking about consultants rather than academics, but people who are not directly involved with this contract or
can
any
just,
particular
can
contract.
Can I just try and bring this to a close, because we could talk about this. For
yeah, but I think they are people who might be able to give us unbiased advice.
Yeah. Can I just suggest that the clerk will come back to us with paper in terms of how we can deal with the roundtable option? And we have another session. We have a session with the permanent sec and the chief information officer, by which we can take evidence at that stage.
I do think Nigel's point is very good. I mean, none of us are experts in this field. It is a very complicated field. No one's got it absolutely right, frankly. I think we do need an advisor on this, and I have a name to suggest to you, and that is
because of what we don't
name names.
Let's
right,
have
okay.
a. Let's have
I'll send
paper,
it to the clerk.
A paper from a clerk, first of all, and then we can discuss how we take it forward. Okay. Is that agreed?
No.
Okay. Thank you. And as agreed previously, colleagues, we can move into private session.